Welcome to the Alex Jones Show on this Wednesday, November 30th, 2016. I'm David Knight, your host. We're going to be joined in this show with many of the InfoWars reporters. Alex is going to have a report at the bottom of this hour looking at yet another CNN hit piece against Alex Jones and trying to attack Donald Trump. We're going to tell you why their news is fake news and our news is not fake news. We're going to analyze that. Alex Jones is going to do it at the bottom of the hour. We're going to talk about it in the next hour. And, of course, it all revolves around the charges of election fraud. So we're going to put some rubber underneath these accusations. This is something that really needs to be examined. And, of course, as we've got Jill Stein and her failed attempt to try to push back against Donald Trump for the person that she said was a criminal, Hillary Clinton, trying to get Hillary Clinton in, very selectively calling for recounts in certain areas. And as I pointed out last night on the Nightly News, this same lawyer who is working with the Hillary Clinton camp and Jill Stein had been hired by George Soros to shut down measures that would have stopped voter fraud in North Carolina. Voter ID. That is not racism. It is not racism to ask for photo ID. Everybody asks for it everywhere. And there's a lot of places where I don't think it should be asked for. But one place where I think it should be asked for is at the voting booth. And that is not intimidation. But of course, Soros used the same lawyer to try to shut that down. And the same lawyer is now saying that in North Carolina, where there is, I believe, last time I looked, it was less than 5,000 vote difference between the Republican and Democrat for governor there. That is very close. That is something that does need to be looked at carefully, does need to have a recount. But he says, don't do it there. But in the areas where there are tens of thousands of votes separating them, the kind of margins that we've never seen overturned by a recount, they want to push ahead for their own political reasons. And we've told you this before. What's behind this is to try to delegitimize the election for Donald Trump, because that's always been a strategy of Soros and his color revolutions throughout the former Soviet Union and other places where he's done that. They're going to use that to inspire the social justice warrior college students to get violent on the street. There's two parts. It's an illegitimate election, and this guy is an authoritarian. So as a result, we see the types of things that CNN is doing, trying to paint Donald Trump as a racist, trying to connect him with the Ku Klux Klan, and also doing the same thing to Alex Jones. I actually put up a picture of Alex Jones with a banner underneath it saying former KKK leader. I mean, that's the kind of dirty, subliminal, not even, I guess you couldn't even say that's subliminal. I mean, that's just overt there. But it's putting a message out there that is absolutely a lie. So Alex is going to talk about that at the bottom of the hour. But of course, we've got a lot of news today that we're going to be talking about. We've had a pick for Treasury Secretary Mnuchin, who has been the finance campaign manager for the Donald Trump campaign since May, I believe it was. Of course, he has connections to Goldman Sachs. That concerns a lot of people. But I'm going to play you some of the clips today as he announced that he's going to be Treasury Secretary. People talk to him, what his priorities are going to be. It looks like he is going right down the economic list of Donald Trump, and that's a very good thing. We still don't have an answer on Mitt Romney. We're going to look at some of these conservative picks. We're going to look a little bit more detail about Tom Price. Politico says he's a radical conservative, and he has a radically conservative vision for American health care. Well, I think that's good. When Politico says that you're a radical conservative, that means you got principles. That means that you're going to try to establish a marketplace, which, again, is what Donald Trump ran on. And we're going to talk about that, some of the news that surfaced about him. Also, we've got OPEC cutting their output in a bid to try to get rid of the oversupply of oil. I don't think they really need to do that. I think what's going to happen is we're going to see a lot of economic growth if Donald Trump's economic policies go through, and we're going to tell you why that's going to happen. But I think they also kind of missed the idea that, you know, we had about a week or so ago, there was this massive discovery of oil in West Texas. They're not going to be able to control the market by trying to dry up the supply of oil. Ain't going to happen. And they're not going to be able to do it politically either, because Donald Trump is going to unleash our economic engine here in this country. Stay with us. We're going to be right back. Welcome to the Alex Jones Show on this Wednesday, November 30th, 2016. I'm David Knight, your host. Here we had an interesting day yesterday, and we're going to talk about some of the things that happened there. And, of course, we've had an interesting day already this morning. We've seen Donald Trump announce his pick for Treasury Secretary. We're going to have Roger Stone joining us in the third and fourth hour today. And, of course, he's going to be talking a lot about the Trump transition team and the picks that we've already seen. I'm sure that's he's going to have a lot to say about that, what we can expect to see going forward. We're also going to have our reporters joining us in the second hour, and we're going to be talking. Alex has a report at the bottom of the hour. There's another hit piece on Alex Jones on CNN yesterday. We're going to show you that. We're going to talk about their tactics, and we're also going to talk about the reality that they don't want to face, and that is that there really is voter fraud. Yes, there's two levels of fraud. There's voter fraud, where you have people who can register to vote who are not technically qualified to vote because they're not citizens. They're citizens of another country, not a citizen of this country. They haven't gone through the legal process to do that. You can also have people who vote multiple times because they don't need to have a voter ID. And, of course, that happens. That happens in places like North Carolina. And, of course, in the run-up to the election in Virginia, there were a large number of people that were turned in one particular county. If you remember, we talked about this at the time. They turned in this list of people, and one of the people in the registrar's office recognized one of the names. She said, wait a minute. I know that guy. He just died. He was, I think, a judge in that county, and he had just died. And so they turned his name in to be registered to vote. That's the type of thing we're going to be talking about in the second hour, the reality of voter fraud. But, of course, there's also the reality of the even larger scheme, and that is using electronic voting, removing the ability to audit the votes, which we saw the director of elections here in Texas do. And that's one of the things that they're trying, that they're discovering here with Jill Stein's quixotic quest to tie the system up. She's not really there to try to reform the system. She was completely silent about all of these different forms of fraud before the election. She's got her own agenda. We understand that. And, of course, she's already failed because she missed the deadline in Pennsylvania by a week, according to the election officials in Pennsylvania. She's clueless about how this entire system works. She can't even read the regulations for filing her objections. She certainly doesn't understand the Electoral College. We're going to be talking about that. We're going to be talking about the Trump transition team. Before we get into that, before we talk about Mnuchin, who was picked today for Treasury Secretary, and I think that's a very positive choice so far, even though he's got connections to Goldman Sachs, and I understand people's concerns about that. I think it's a very positive choice. When he came out and talked about this today, you could see that he was exactly on the same page with Donald Trump. And I think Trump understands that the economic issue is number one, front and center, and that economic issue is jobs. And so yesterday, we saw, although it began at the beginning of the day with an attack on constitutional freedoms, talking about burning flags, it ended at the end of the day with him talking about how he had saved jobs by doing a deal with Carrier. We're going to talk about that. What is that deal? We don't know the details of the deal yet. But I got to say that people looked at this and it got a lot of people upset about the flag burning thing. I don't like what he had to say about the flag burning thing, but and we'll talk about that. But this is exactly what I thought we would see from Donald Trump. I thought he'd save jobs and he'd attack constitutional freedoms. Now, Hillary Clinton would have attacked constitutional freedoms and not saved jobs. She would have sent them abroad. So that's a positive thing. But I think it's also positive when we look at the way that he came out to attack us. Would you rather have somebody like Barack Obama or Hillary Clinton, who's all smiles and handshakes about the Constitution to your face, who tell you that they're all for mom apple pie and freedom of speech, and then behind the scenes, they work very diligently to shut down freedom of speech? And of course, we have a news item today on InfoWars.com, how Apple is purging Breitbart News from its iTunes store. Again, this is the fake news narrative. We'll be talking about that more later in the show. But would you rather have somebody who uses the Federal Election Commission, as they've talked about, to try to shut down free speech or to do things with the internet, accusing people of being terrorists or whatever, to try to shut down the internet, all the different things that Hillary Clinton and Obama would do to shut down the internet? Or would you have somebody who comes out and in a very brute force insult to the First Amendment, he puts everybody on guard, and we get to talk about what the principles are that are involved in it. I think that's a more positive way to do this. And he has no way that he's going to get this enforced. So when he comes out and he talks about this, and he does it in a very crude way. And again, it's a dog whistle to his base. And it's also a reflection of his past history. I think that what he was doing yesterday was he's showing his base, look, I'm going to be there for you. I'm going to get jobs. And for those of you who are with the military, who are the police that I support, I'm going to talk about the flag. It just kind of came out of nowhere. There weren't any riots going on yesterday to start this. But in both of these cases, he is talking to his base, saying, I'm going to stay with the things that you elected me to do. I want to look at the situation with the war on the flag first. Now let's talk about the jobs first. Let's talk about the jobs. Yesterday evening, we had the deal with Carrier that they said was going to be announced. And the tweets that came out from Carrier, first they said, "We are pleased to reach a deal with President-elect Trump and Vice President-elect Pence to keep close to 1,000 jobs in Indianapolis. More details soon." Then President-elect Trump said, "I will be going to Indiana on Thursday to make a major announcement concerning Carrier air conditioning staying in Indianapolis. Great deal for workers. Big day on Thursday for Indiana and the great workers of that wonderful state. We will keep our company and jobs in the U.S. Thanks, Carrier." So we're going to find out what the details of that deal are. But remember, on Thanksgiving Day, Donald Trump said, "Hey, I'm working even on Thanksgiving Day to get Carrier to keep their facility in the United States." And I think that's amazing. Everybody that knows Trump, and you can see this, look at how hard he worked during the campaign compared to Hillary Clinton, for example, who could barely stand up. He was flying, crisscrossing the country, holding multiple giant events, a lot of energy, and we have seen a couple of very positive signs. While he's not even elected president, he's hit the ground running already, doing things like this. As his Treasury pick, Mnuchin, said, "I haven't seen a president do that for a very long time. I can't remember a president trying to keep jobs in America, not in my lifetime. I don't think Mnuchin's any older than I am, but I haven't ever seen a president try to do anything to keep jobs in this country." Since Richard Nixon, we have had presidents who have been campaigning to take jobs out of this country. I mean, that's been the reality of what's behind this opening to China with Kissinger, the NAFTA trade deals, the deals with China. They have been working very hard to get jobs out of this country, to get foreign workers into this country to take your jobs. That's been what we have seen before. So the fact that he hit the ground running with this, the fact that he has been successful, I think that's very important. What kind of a deal did he do? I hope it's not a situation where he is giving them financial incentives, crony capitalism, to stay here. We've seen this with Elon Musk getting billions of dollars, many cases. Typically, the way this works out on state levels, these guys get so much in terms of tax benefits and subsidies and other things that it works out costing the taxpayer hundreds of thousands of dollars for every job that is theoretically created. I hope that's not the situation here. I hope that he picked up the phone with them and said, "Look, we're going to set up a situation where we're going to not have favorable tariffs for people who manufacture outside of our country." And oh, by the way, there's this other thing that's happening throughout the world. Back in the middle of September, if you remember, Obama and John Kerry went to Rwanda and they signed an agreement with most of the other countries of the world saying they're going to get rid of air conditioning coolant. I told my sons at the time that happened, I said, "Hey, guys, be ready to live in a world without air conditioning." And my son's Lance said, "From my cold, dead hands." Exactly. But that's what they want to do. They want to shut down all Freon forms, all coolants, and understand that what's really behind this is that there's a couple of people with connections to government here in America and in China who have come up with a new replacement for the coolants that we're currently using. So they would like to have a monopoly on that. They would like everybody to be forced to buy that. That's usually what is behind all of this stuff, all of these unicorn fart regulations. And I call it unicorn farts. Today, we see that in California, they're seriously going to try to regulate cow farts. So it's not as strange as things look. Reality gets even stranger. But I hope he explained to them that it's going to be in their interest that they can manufacture air conditioning units that use real Freon in the United States for the United States market, because we're not going to go down that ridiculous road that the rest of the world is doing. So, hey, guys, if you put your factory in another country, maybe you're going to have some problems with that other country in terms of regulations. Maybe they could get around that by putting the Freon in when it gets in the United States. But he's also going to put some taxes on as it passes across the border. So hopefully it was done in that kind of vein. Hopefully it is not a crony capitalism thing. But let's talk about the flag issue, because Donald Trump has been in flag wars before. Remember the flag war that he had in Palm Beach County? And this was something I went back into the Wayback Machine flashback. This is a Politico article about it. They're talking about the regulatory environment there in Palm Beach. They said, "First, you need to know Palm Beach is a town where measurements matter. Leaf blowers require inspectors to verify that they emit no more than 65 decibels from 50 feet away. They regulate the amount of noise of leaf blowers. They hold people who are having garage sales are restricted to one sign that can be no more than 4 square feet in size, and residents who are flying flags on their property are restricted to flagpoles no higher than 42 feet, flags that are a maximum of 4 feet by 6 feet. I mean, that's the kind of regulations that they have. He was fined $5,000 because he replaced a section of dead hedges with new hedges that were alive, but they weren't quite tall enough. So the town of Palm Beach put that on him. I mean, why would you want to live in a place like that? But I'm sure that got under his skin. And that's a great thing when you got a president who has seen excessive regulation. I think it's one of the reasons why he tweeted out, hey, I'm going to get rid of about 70% of the regulations. I don't know. Put a number on it like that, he doesn't have an exact number, but there is a lot to be cut there. So we're going to talk about his war in support of the flag. We're going to talk about the story that's on InfoWars.com. A Navy vet's home was vandalized and torched by anti-Trump extremists. And then we're going to talk about this burning of the American flag and where that fits in free speech. Stay with us. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, your host. I want to get back to this issue of flag burning. As I said yesterday, we began. Yesterday, we saw exactly what I expected to see from Donald Trump. Jobs being saved here in America, even before he becomes president. And again, another attack against some constitutional freedoms. And I want to tell you that this is part of a struggle that he's been working with a long time. I want to talk about his fight with Palm Beach on trying to fly the flag there. And of course, that was a fight where he was definitely on the right side. They were trying to shut down his free expression in terms of flying that flag. We're also going to talk about a Navy vet whose home was vandalized and torched by anti-Trump extremists. So they didn't, you want to talk about people burning flags and then getting attacked. Well, he put up a sign and they burned his home. So let's put some things in perspective. We're going to talk about the principles involved here and how this is playing out. Before we do, real quickly, I just want to let you know that we've got some extended sales that are going to be ending today. This is the last day of these sales that have been extended from Black Friday. We've extended the Black Friday sale 30 to 40% off InfoWars Select Storable Food at InfoWarsStore.com. That is a huge savings. 30 to 40% off are already a very competitive price on storable foods. These are going to last for 25 years, all made in the USA, all non-GMO, all packaged in a kind of packaging, as you can see at the website. Very high-quality packaging, and even Ziploc seals, so that when you finally break that seal, you can reseal it for short-term preservation there as well. Also, when you go to InfoWarsLife.com, we also have a couple of supplements that have been put on a massive discount, 30% off Super Male Vitality and Silver Bullet, 50% off. Both of those are at InfoWarsLife.com. Both of those are going to end today. Today is the final sale for those three things, actually. Super Male Vitality, 30% off. Silver Bullet, 50% off. And 30 to 40% off InfoWars Select Storable Food. Now, as I was pointing out before we went to the break, in Palm Beach, highly regulated industry. And that's a good thing for a president to be fighting back against that. And that's what he did. And he fought against them on the flag issue. He had been penalized by them $5,000, as I pointed out, for cutting down a dead hedge and then putting up one that was alive. And they said, well, it's not as high as it was before, so here's a $5,000 fine. Can you imagine living somewhere like that? And then they regulate everything from the amount of noise that your leaf blower has to the size that your garage sale sign can be, and, of course, the height and the size of your flag. Well, he completely ignored that. He put up an 80-foot flagpole on the front of lawn of Mar-a-Lago. They said he had a car dealership-sized American flag, 15 feet by 25 feet, flying from it. And he knew what he was doing, says Politico, and he did. It was a protest, okay? Trump had been fighting with the town poobahs from the very moment he got there, as they point out on Politico, and he was plainly inviting a lawsuit. And Trump said this. He went on Nancy Grace's show and said, the town council of Palm Beach should be ashamed of itself for putting regulations and fining me for putting up the American flag. This is probably a first in the U.S. history. They started fining him several hundred dollars a day. The fine grew to $120,000, and then he filed a lawsuit against Palm Beach asking for $25 million in damages. And let me say this. I've lived in some places where there were a lot of regulations on signs and other things in North Carolina, but they always made exceptions for flags, especially for the American flag. Some places would exempt all flags, but pretty much all of them in North Carolina would exempt the American flag. That's why you see it flying so much at car dealerships, because it gets attention and it gets around the regulations on their own signs. But, you know, flying a flag is political speech, and he exercised that, and he prevailed. They essentially did a deal, as Donald Trump does. They waived the $120,000 worth of fines that they had done, and he agreed to give $100,000 to veterans' charities, and it worked out. And he made his point, and that's the whole point that we're looking at here. You have to understand that when we talk about the flag, and if you say that it is a symbol of our Constitution, a symbol of the free speech that you fought for, I agree. But we have to not destroy the thing itself in order to protect the symbol of the thing. You understand? The real thing is free political speech. And burning a flag is political speech. Justice Scalia said that as well. And so we know that when you put that out there, we don't want somebody getting their home burned because of their political speech. We don't want somebody getting attacked because they're wearing a Donald Trump hat or getting their car destroyed at a rally. We don't want to see that happening. And we don't want to see threats from people like Joe Manchin saying, yeah, you can burn a flag, but then I'm going to punch you out. Or Donald Trump saying, we're going to take your citizenship or put you in jail. That isn't going to happen. It's good that we can have that kind of discussion, though. And I'm glad that it is a frontal attack. Understand, the other people would have done that as well. When we come back from the break, Alex Jones is going to talk about the latest attack from CNN trying to paint us as fake news. No, their news is fake about voter fraud. He'll be right back with us right at the bottom after we come back from break. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, your host. We're going to have Alex pushing back against the CNN attack on him yesterday. But, of course, we have another article on Infowars.com today showing how this is stacking up. Apple has purged Breitbart News' app from the iTunes store. See, everywhere we look, we're seeing this kind of censorship. This is the pushback. They're using the fake news, the hoax news, labeling Breitbart, labeling Infowars. Is that because they've pushed out the conspiracy theory for so long, calling people that it hasn't worked? So they've got to come up with a new term. That was something, of course, that if you question the official story, going back to JFK, we had the FBI, CIA, the government coming out saying, oh, they're conspiracy theorists. I don't believe that one guy with a gun could get all those different angles on the president. But we have this magic bullet theory. And forget the witnesses that were there that heard shots from the front. Forget the Zapruder film. Forget all that stuff. If you do that, you're a conspiracy theorist. They have used that to gaslight people for 60 years, is it now? It was 50 years, I think. So it's about 53 years, I think. So they've used that. It's getting old. It really got old this last time. So now they're going to fake news. Now they are purging news. And, of course, Apple setting up their own news filters. Facebook setting up their own news filters. That is a very important but very subtle attack, but there's a more open attack on free speech and on the news outlets that really did carry the day, like Infowars, like Breitbart, and that's what we're going to play for you coming up from Alex in just one moment. One of the things I think is important, okay, there's also some breaking news. I just asked the guys during the break if they'd had the vote for Pelosi. You know, it looked like they were going to have their own transition team with the Democrats as well, but it looks like she won that and is going to remain as a minority leader in the House. When we look at the pushback on Donald Trump in terms of trying to divest himself of business stuff, everybody forgets how Nancy Pelosi used all these different issues to ingratiate herself. But we're going to talk about that more. Let's go to Alex talking about the CNN report that aired last night.
It's been a cozy relationship from the beginning.
I will not let you down. You will be very, very impressed, I hope. And I think we'll be speaking a lot. But
Donald Trump and Alex Jones, the conservative conspiracy theorist and operator of the website Infowars, which seems to be a place where Trump gets a lot of his information. Jones can take credit for spearheading some of the most outrageous theories on the internet, from claims that 9/11 was a government conspiracy to the Sandy Hook shooting being faked. Jones' theories reach tens of millions each month and are now often echoed by the next president of the United States.
The controlled corporate fake press, after losing the election 3 weeks ago, has only massively intensified their deception campaign against the American people. They are now censoring Infowars.com, GrudgeReport.com out of major libraries, out of Wi-Fi being provided across the country and the world. They're putting out fake news lists, and then those sites are being delisted. Breitbart had its app just deleted out of the iTunes store. We've had things like that done to us as well. This is unprecedented what's taking place. Now, I started getting calls yesterday afternoon when I was driving home at about 6 with people saying, yeah, they just flashed it up on TV. Coming up, the man that Donald Trump gets his info from, and they said it said under it, KKK leader in the promos. But by the time the show actually came on, they weren't showing the KKK leader garbage. But here's why this is important. It's done not subliminally, but in plain view. So I call it kind of quasi-subliminal, which is total yellow journalism on multiple levels. It says former KKK leader endorses Stephen Bannon. And then it's under me, under Alex Jones, under my face from a video about a completely separate subject. And then they pop up the name Alex Jones under it. So if you're a TV viewer, we're showing you that right now. So this is how they deceive. This is how they manipulate. This is how stupid they think their readers, their viewers are. I mean, this is unprecedented. The one other time I saw them do something like this was Fox. And it was Bill O'Reilly talking about sexual predators online and then cut to a video of me yelling about corrupt government. Had nothing to do with it, with my face turning red.
You know what it's like to go to sleep every night knowing you work for a bunch of psychotic killers, and you bastards are probably going to end up killing me one day?
Hate speech. Now Facebook is apologizing for allowing it worldwide. But can anything be done to stop the hatred, which is directly linked into the IRS Tea Party scandal? Facebook having a terrible problem with that, and recently hatred against women has caused a major controversy. Postings have encouraged violence, rape, other atrocities against women. Hate speech is not a difficult thing to identify. It's based on personal attacks designed to injure. That's hate speech, and Facebook knows it.
So it's just, say the word child molester and show somebody's face, or say the word KKK and show somebody's face. It is the lowest level of just baseless disinfo. And again, I say it's almost subliminal because you're just there watching the news, and you see Alex Jones's face, and then it says KKK leader, and then it says Alex Jones promoting something that's coming up. It's just all done to mix it together and to deceive people in a massive way. Now, I've got to be honest with the viewers and listeners. I've kind of gotten punched drunk to this. I am so accustomed to just mega-level deception by the fake news media, who dubs us fake media, total inversion of reality, that I've just gotten, I don't even pay attention to it very often. When I say hundreds of articles a day attacking me by name, it's hundreds. Now, 30 years ago, that would destroy somebody. But it only empowers us, and therein lies the delusion of these people. All the thinking people, every race, color, and creed, now understand this media is foreign-owned, globalist-run, out to get us. They see the Pope lecturing us and telling us what we should do, and the communist Chinese, and the Saudi Arabians, and everybody else, and they see through it. But truly, the reason they're trying to derail what Trump is doing and calling it racist and demonizing it is because it will end their global system. If America is allowed to operate outside of globalism and is prosperous, that American system will outcompete it. And if you go back to the robber barons 100 years ago, they all wrote news articles in Europe, in England, and in the U.S. admitting that they couldn't compete with the American system because it wasn't centralized, it wasn't all based on small combines, oligopolies and monopolies. So Trump's fight is the old fight. It's the American fight. That's why it's so powerful. It's not just some ideology he went and made up somewhere. So when the media sits there at Reddit or the New York Times and says, what is globalism? Does it exist? No. It's like telling a child that A, B, C, D, E, F, G doesn't exist. It's like saying that George Washington didn't exist. But that's the level of deception and just waging war on reality that they're involved in, because they are at war with reality, because what they're selling, authoritarianism, as some neoliberal wonderful cosmology, is so ridiculous no one wants to buy it. Freedom and free association is like the greatest gourmet smorgasbord cornucopia selection the world could ever imagine, compared to standing in line for 2 or 3 days to get a couple sausages and potatoes. And again, it wasn't the communist systems couldn't produce. They didn't want to produce. They used the limited production and the artificial scarcity they create to control people, and they write textbooks on it. And that's why globalism is so evil. It is a worldwide system of austerity and being poor and the people being ignorant and people being played off against each other. So the fact that they are upping their game 24/7 attacking Stephen Bannon and yours truly, Alex Jones, tells you something. They know Stephen Bannon is a patriot and an anti-globalist and wants to launch a plan to make even the poorest people wealthy in comparison to other nations. He's openly said that. That is their plan. Carrier air conditioning's already coming back. Ford's already coming back. Apple says they may come back before he's even in office. And they're attacking yours truly because if they can get Trump to cut away from his base, it's not just crippling Trump. It will cut him off from Americana, which they're trying to dub as racist and evil for us to have level playing fields and control borders and basic sovereignty. So Trump is purposely invoking nationalism and red meat stuff like don't burn the American flag to force the left to then begin defending free speech, something they've actually been attacking, something they're coming out and bulldozing. They want to yell about free speech burning the flag all day, and I agree, you have a right to do it, even though I don't like it. But they're the ones banning stuff off Facebook, off Twitter, the Apple purges. So some people say, oh, that's Apple's company. They can. No, they approve your app. It goes through the deal. Then they kick you off. Three times we had Obama deception paid for by third-party companies, encoded and loaded and accepted. And then they would delete it one day after. And they go, oh, it's a mistake. Apple wants the $5,000 again. And we encoded it again and put it through. I had Google refused to sell in Google Store, and they shut our store down. That was an article that happened a few years ago, I guess 7 years ago now. And it just banned us and said, this is a racist film. We are not allowing you to sell it or have an Apple or a Google Store. So this is what they're doing, folks. This is serious censorship, and they're throwing it in everybody's face while saying they're, quote, the liberals. They're doing this because they're desperate. They're doing this because the ideas that I promote and that Stephen Bannon and others promote is poison to these people and will bring their system down. So for the new viewers and new listeners, this is not my opinion. The things we're talking about here are admitted by the enemy, by the globalists in their own publications and documents. And once we identify the globalists and their globalist system and get the public to actually go read and research what's really happening, it's game over for them. So some family and others say, how am I taking it with these new levels of deception? I'm taking it fine. It means I'm having an effect. It means the great crew at InfoWars is having an effect. It means the listeners of this radio show and TV show are spreading the word and taking action. But do not take any of this for granted. They are trying to shut us down, and they can shut down Breitbart or Drudge or InfoWars. If they can get any one of those, they set the precedent to take everything else out. And they were on the verge. They handed over the internet to the UN and a multinational consortium. They were about to get 5 Supreme Court justices, at least 4. They were imploding everything. The borders are already been completely lowered. The drones were turned off. They were already, you know, telling us that, you know, jihadis were going to be put in every town, every city. They're that close to finishing their operation. Let's just pray Trump's for real, because in a modern sense, he is our best and only hope for rectifying this in a peaceful manner. Because let me tell you something, the globalists are not going to be peaceful next phase. They're not going to coexist with us. They cannot coexist with a free market, open, true liberal society.
Jones posted this video entitled An Emergency Message to Donald Trump During the Campaign.
I am going to ask you to seriously think about making the issue of Hillary's election fraud in the primaries one of the central issues to defeating her in November.
Trump had this to say a day later.
I'm afraid the election's going to be rigged, I have to be honest, because I think my side was rigged.
And in the wake of the election, Jones pushing a theory that despite the vote totals, Trump actually won the popular vote.
Millions of illegals voting, at least 5 states being stolen for Hillary. We're talking 5, 6, 7, 8 million people more voting for Trump, if you look at the evidence, in the popular vote than did.
And Trump tweeting just 4 days later, quote, In addition to winning the Electoral College in a landslide, I won the popular vote if you deduct the millions of people who voted illegally.
I'll tell you, it is surreal to talk about issues here on air and then word for word hear Trump say it 2 days later.
And I'm not just calling ourselves liberal because that takes it away from them. Liberalism, if you studied it 200 years ago, is antithetical to modern liberalism. It is the complete 180 opposite. Liberalism means do what you want as long as you hurt somebody else, but I can live the way I want. Don't come force me to live the way you say I should. Look at political correctness. Look at all this garbage. Liberalism means lower taxes, private property rights, religious freedoms, or freedom not have religion. See, it's the opposite. Everything they're pushing is Hajibs on TV with the news anchors, but you can't wear a cross. It's all about henpecking and getting us in line to just accept incredible outrages. And that's why the Republican and Democratic establishments are panicking and freaking out. But I've got to say, CNN discredits itself with crap like this, and it really, really shows how their entire system is based around race baiting, and it really is a despicable, despicable news organization. And quite frankly, I don't even give them interviews when they ask for interview requests, because they always just talk to me for like 5 minutes and use a short clip to act like they were journalists and act like they got my response. But they don't even call now to try to get a response whenever they take what we say out of context or twist things, because these are not journalists, folks. They know they're paid mercenaries. They know they're paid hacks. And they know good and damn well they're trying to basically undermine this country. They've conquered us. That's why they're so arrogant. And people have to understand that if you're under their mind control, under their spell, come out of it, folks. They are predators. They are bad news. They did back the Arab Spring. They did back starting wars with Russia. These are very bad people. And we've got to bring nationalism back in a big way, folks. It's how we could organize against globalism, because at least a nation has a chance for the people to run it and to fix it. Under globalism, it's a worldwide system. You can't get out of it unless nations begin to pull out of it, and that's happening. So a modern war is taking place right now of the nation state and individuals and self-determination against the modern royalty. The true definition of globalism is third wave corporate colonialism, establishing a planetary above the law corporate dictatorship. I mean, that's what it is. And so no one should want to live under that. And there's no arguments that you can push for that. But now their new argument is we're going to, quote, be liberal world government. They actually say that in The Economist. And we're going to enforce racial equity worldwide. That means playing people off against each other and using third world populations against the West. I mean, this is dastardly. This is dirty. And this is how the corporations play, who are exploiting everybody. We've got to be smart enough to come together, turn on the real renaissance. Basically terraform the planet for clean, renewable technocracy for the people to actually decentralize power instead of a technocracy that's based on total surveillance and dehumanization. We've got to have a purpose-based economy, purpose-based world. We've got to launch space colonies, undersea colonies. We've got to trailblaze and make our heroes again, people on the very cutting edge, and celebrate our humanity and not give it up like the eugenicist-based technocrats are now pushing. I'm Alex Jones, signing off for Infowars.com. And I go ahead and hand the baton back to David Knight in the full broadcast he's got lined up today. And I'll be back later with a special report. Turkey has declared war on Syria. Does this mean that World War III is about to erupt? That's Infowars.com. And even the London Telegraph says that most experts agree this could trigger the next Third World War, because when Turkey declares war against Syria, Syria is allied with Russia. That means a NATO nation has now declared war on Russia. That's what this really means. Stay with us.
Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, your host. I want to give you a feel for Donald Trump's Treasury Secretary pick, Mnuchin. He had some comments today. I want to play a couple of those in just one moment. Before we do, real quickly, I want to remind you that we have extended for a final day some of our Black Friday specials, our Cyber Monday specials. We have 30% off Survival Shield X2. That's our nascent iodine. And also 30% off Super Male Vitality. Both of those are at InfoWarsLife.com. 50% off Silver Bullet, also at InfoWarsLife.com. And 30 to 40% off InfoWars select storable food. So check out these massive discounts. We're only going to have these for one more day. 30% off Survival Shield X2 Nascent Iodine and Super Male Vitality, 50% off Silver Bullet, and 30 to 40% off InfoWars select storable food. This is a great time to stock up. We really appreciate your support. That is what has helped us have such a big impact that they are doing regular hit pieces on CNN, just as they're trying to ban us and shut us down, trying to shut us down through the news aggregators that they're creating with Apple's operating system, as well as taking Breitbart out of the App Store. So this is the kind of pushback that they're doing. As Alex pointed out in that last piece, it's absolutely amazing to see the dishonest fake news of CNN putting his picture up there, then putting a lower thirds underneath it, former Ku Klux Klan leader, and not saying coming up or anything, just former Ku Klux Klan leader, and then underneath that, Alex Jones and InfoWars.com. I mean, how incredibly dishonest that is. But that's the kind of below-the-belt attacks that they do. We're going to talk about the real voter fraud coming up in the next hour. We're going to have Owen Schroyer and Darren McBreen joining me, and we've got another report from Alex Jones coming up. But let's take a look at what Mnuchin, who has been the campaign finance manager for Donald Trump since May, and he was announced as Trump's pick for Treasury Secretary. Let's take a look at what he said in terms of his vision for the economy.
How much money is sitting overseas right now? We're talking about $2 trillion or something?
It's a staggering number.
I mean,
first of all, the reason why American companies don't bring the cash back is because the differential in tax rates. So the combination of lowering the corporate tax and a one-time 10% repatriation tax, absolutely going to get cash back here. I mean, if you look at Apple, Apple's kind of the classic company. They're sitting on hundreds of billions of dollars of cash, and they go out and borrow money against their overseas bank accounts. This makes no sense. And they've said the reason why they're doing that is because of like high corporate tax rates. So we think there's going to be hundreds of billions, if not trillions of dollars, that's going to come back, and that's going to create infrastructure and create jobs.
Well, it makes no sense on one level, but it makes a lot of sense on another level because you've got 0% interest rates.
Right, but you already have Apple talking about now bringing factories back.
I love
it. Did you hear that last year or the year before? No.
Exactly.
Okay, and that was also the other person you heard talking there was Ross, who is a pick for a commerce secretary. Yeah, we want to get companies to base themselves back in the United States again. Is that a bad idea? How about stopping them from moving to another country in the first place? And, of course, that's something that Donald Trump has been working on very hard. He was working on it on Thanksgiving. They announced a carrier deal, as I pointed out before. We don't know what it is, but it is an effort by someone who's not even become president yet, and already he's keeping jobs in the United States. Mnuchin said the carrier deal, I think, is terrific. He said the president-elect and the vice president picked up the phone, called the CEO of United Technologies, told them that we want to keep jobs here, and this is it. He said, I can't remember the last time a president did that. This is going to be a terrific opportunity. That's why we're so hopeful. Donald Trump is working very hard, and we're going to talk in the next hour as well about the announcements that he is going to diverge himself from these business issues. Why? Because his first priority is being president. We've already seen that with the settlement that he made on that lawsuit. We're talking more about that in the next hour with Owen Schroyer and Darren McBreen. Stay with us. We'll be right back.
18-year-old Somali refugee Abdul Razak Ali Artan, who obtained a green card to enter the United States in 2014, injured 11 students on the Ohio State University campus yesterday, first striking them with a car and then exiting the car to attack the students with a butcher knife. WorldNet Daily reports campus police chief Craig Stone said, "Our officer was on the scene in less than a minute, and he ended the situation in less than a minute. He engaged the suspect, and he eliminated the threat. The suspect is DOA. Artan had been quoted in the campus newspaper, The Lantern, several months ago, complaining about the school's lack of Islamic prayer rooms. He blamed the negative view Americans have of Muslims on Islamophobia planted in their minds by the U.S. media, not by the numerous terror attacks or sexual assaults. And the delusional blame game continues to mushroom. Tariq Nasheed, an extreme left documentary filmmaker, bemoaned, "So white officer Alan Haruko, who shot and killed the black Somali stabbing suspect in Ohio, is being paraded as a hero? That's interesting." Anti-Second Amendment Senator Tim Kaine tweeted, "Deeply saddened by the senseless act of gun violence at Ohio State this morning. Praying for the injured and the entire Buckeye community." Of course, no gun was used. Paul Joseph Watson pointed out that a woman named Kay tweeted, "Poor kid goes through hell as a child in Somalia, comes to America, probably been bullied by racists in white Ohio. Now he's dead. Thanks, Trump." And even the New World Order chimed in as Anna de Rothschild tweeted, "Thoughts and prayers are with the victims in Ohio. America must wake up and abolish your Second Amendment. It is 100% the problem. Trump is blind." Meanwhile, back here in reality that exists 24/7 outside of the Twitter universe, people in Columbus, Ohio now have more reason to be looking over their shoulder. As recent as February of 2016, Mohammed Berry, a Muslim immigrant from Guinea, charged into the Nazareth restaurant and deli in Columbus, Ohio, and attacked the patrons with a machete in what was described as a bloodbath. Berry was shot dead. CNSNews.com reports 98,799 Somali refugees have settled in the United States since 9/11. More than 99% of those refugees are Muslim, reflecting the religious makeup of Somalia's population, which is almost entirely Muslim, predominantly Sunni. The largest number of Somali refugees arriving in the country since 9/11 have been settled in Minnesota, almost 16,000, Ohio, more than 7,500, and sizable communities also in Texas, New York, and Arizona. America chose Trump for a reason. Paul Joseph Watson writes, "Just 3 weeks ago, Trump cautioned that Somali migrants in states such as Minnesota were refusing to integrate and that a portion of them posed a terror threat. Some of them are joining ISIS and spreading their extremist views all over our country and all over the world," said Trump. Of course, no one wants to call it a terror attack, but Barry and Artan were just following orders from terrorists. Business Insider reports, Michael Smith, the founder of security from Kronos Advisory, who has advised Congress on terror-related issues, pointed out on Twitter that an ISIS video released days before the OSU attack showed a French ISIS member demonstrating how to kill people using knives. The ISIS member also called for attacks in the West, and in the past 2 months, English-language ISIS propaganda magazines have called for vehicle and knife attacks. Sorry, Anna de Rothschild and Senator Tim Kaine. Thanks to people like you and your globalist policies, this is precisely why Americans need their Second Amendment rights. John Bound for Infowars.com.
Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight here with Owen Schroer and Dara McBreen, a couple of our other reporters. We're going to be talking about the attack piece on Alex Jones by CNN, then this narrative of fake news. But, of course, we just heard that report from John Bound at the top of the hour talking about how the left is trying to defend this guy who attacked people in OSU. And, of course, I've got an article here from Politico, solidly in the Hillary Clinton left camp, solidly attacking Donald Trump, saying Trump tweets that the alleged OSU attacker should not have been in our country. They think this is a winning issue. That's how out of touch they are with the electorate. And, of course, Trump said on Wednesday morning that the OSU student who allegedly wounded, okay, I don't know that we need the allegedly there, several people during a stabbing attack was, quote, a refugee who should not have been in our country. You know, were these people, was he vetted? When I saw these reports, guys, they didn't even know what his age was. Plus or minus 5 years. They don't know anything about this guy, and yet he is a legal permanent resident. This is what Donald Trump said from the very beginning. They tried to push this thing by saying, well, you know, he wanted to ban all Muslims. No, what he was saying was we need to stop all immigration from certain countries until we can vet the people who are coming in so we don't have this exact thing. He was proven right, and now they continue to try to attack him, saying, look, he's attacking Muslims. No, it's Muslims who are attacking us.
By the way, Jimmy Carter did the same thing during his administration in the 70s.
Yeah.
Right. And that was to stop any people from Iran coming in, and they were seriously vetted, and a lot of them were not allowed into the country because of the whole Iran crisis and the whole hostage crisis.
That's right.
So, they always try to point and make this a kind of a Republican type of thing, but the Democrats did the same thing in the 70s.
That's right.
Well, how are you supposed to properly vet people that come from a country that doesn't have any infrastructure? How are you supposed to find out somebody's age who doesn't even know it themselves?
Yeah.
So we know that this is going on, and this is something that, you know, refugee programs have to deal with. I mean, this is a humanitarian effort to take care of these people. But the problem is ISIS knows this. So what they do is they infiltrate these refugee groups. They say, oh, I don't know my age. You know, I don't know where I came from. I'm from a country with no infrastructure.
And of course, the problem is we created ISIS, and we created the regime overthrow that created the refugees. I mean, we created that. So when you look at the Aleppo boy and your heart goes out to him, as it should, understand that it was Hillary Clinton who set the Middle East on fire, who created this situation, and who tried to do everything they can to prevent the Assad regime or the Russians who are working with them to try to stop this and get back to a peaceful situation.
Well, hold on a minute.
They're not
David,
better off.
CNN says that's a conspiracy.
That's right.
I heard it last night.
It is a conspiracy, but it's not a theory, okay? Let's talk about the fake news of CNN. We've got a Trump economist, Steve Moore, who takes him on. I want to play this clip and get your comments on this.
And when I say fake news, I mean stories that are designed to trick people into believing lies.
Let's be clear. Donald Trump will lose the election.
Right now, Donald Trump will lose the election.
I mean, if you look at the battleground states right now, Donald Trump's going to lose.
This is different what Donald Trump's doing. It's sinister. It reeks of Joe McCarthy.
Texas is still competitive.
Is the election over? I mean, a lot of political scientists would say at this point, nothing matters.
Today, Citibank said if Trump's elected, the market will go down 3-5%.
If Donald Trump wins the election, the stock market will tank.
I mean, and that would hurt the stock market.
If Trump were to win, you know, the stock market would go down.
You know, one of the pillars of the infamous blue wall.
Think about if she can hold there, that's a key part of that blue wall.
Trump clearly going after that blue wall.
It's whether Hillary Clinton's going to win by small margin or whether we're going to essentially annihilate Donald Trump.
I think Hillary will win.
And most analysts are saying that Hillary Clinton's going to win in a landslide.
I still think it's likely that Hillary Clinton will win.
38-40% of people, roughly speaking, are going to have voted for Trump.
And if Donald Trump does lose, particularly if he loses in the face of a massive turnout from Latino communities.
But there's an invisible surge with Latinos.
The surge of the Latino vote, that's going to be enough.
The surge in Hispanic Latino voting.
This is the number right here we're all going to be talking about after the election. It is the Hispanic vote.
But the surge of Latino voters,
African American voters and Hispanic voters and college educated white women especially, are coming out in droves.
He claims that the media is lying and that its reporting cannot be believed. So Donald Trump will lose.
They're the most basic, pure form of fake news.
Yeah, the most purest form of fake news. You just saw it, the clips from the mainstream media themselves. And everybody has seen that. Just a reminder and that real tight clip of what they've been lying to you about. And so they're trying to get that back. And, of course, they can't let go, guys, of this notion that Donald Trump actually won. I mean, you were trying to drag them into reality, kicking and screaming, but they keep screaming and kicking even louder, trying to say, we're going to pull this back. Oh, the Electoral College has got to go, this and that. We're going to have a revolt of electors. None of that's going to happen. And yet this piece that they did last night, when we said, yeah, there really is election fraud. There really is voter fraud.
Everybody
knows
that.
Yeah, we know that. And so you want to create this false illusion that Hillary Clinton, and it's amazing to watch this after the election. These people continue to persist, but I keep watching her vote total grow. You know, well, she's going to win by 1 million votes. No, by 1.5 million, 2 million, 2.5. And then the last one I saw, I think it was on Daily News, they said, well, currently she's leading by 2.5 million. It's like, well, folks, the real election ended about 3 weeks ago, but you keep pushing this and you keep padding it. And that's precisely why we need the Electoral Colleges as a firewall against the corruption, where in places like New York, they can continue to pad the vote.
Well, The Onion ought to write a story. Hillary Clinton wins by 100 million votes, because, you know, that's what they'll do next. They'll just have 100 million people show up to vote. But this is amazing. This is the second time that the Clinton campaign is going to try to have their cake and eat it, too. Let's remember, they said that there's no such thing as rigged elections. Don't worry about voter fraud. We've got it under control. But meanwhile, out of the other side of their mouth, they're saying that Russia is hacking the elections. We need to beware of Russia. We've got people, you know, overlooking the elections to make sure they're happening. So they tried to have their cake and eat it too there. Now they're trying to do it again. They're demonizing Donald Trump for talking about illegal voting or voter fraud while they're recounting the election.
And of course, she said that it was absolutely, it was going to destroy the fabric of American democracy to question the results of the election.
Yeah, the peaceful, it's a tradition to overchange power peacefully.
That's right.
Well, yeah. CNN, they're digging their own grave. All right. They've lost all touch with the American people. I mean, they're basically tabloid journalism. And the more these hit pieces come out, I think, thanks for the plug. I mean, a lot of people, they had... I'll give him this
much. It looked good.
For the first time, at least I saw Alex Jones. Pictures of Alex looked good. Yeah. You know, usually they'll show him from like 2006 in our old studio to kind of give us a, you know, not such a credibility look. And at least he...
Or like Bill O'Reilly did on Fox News. Just show him red-faced screaming and about something that has anything to do with what he's talking about mm-hmm. there. Just take a little short little clip there to try to make him look bad. Let's... go to an interview that Alex had after the election with Bev Harris. This is somebody who follows election fraud. She's a Democrat. We've had her on every election to talk about the real issues that we need to be concerned about. And this is something we should not let go of is are things that we could do to improve the honest and true election that we have. And there's a lot of systemic fraud that is built into this, from not having people's voter IDs to allowing electronic voting machines where you deliberately shut down the auditing capability. Those things need to be looked at by everybody. Left and right needs to come back and look at that. But that's not how they're using this. And so I want to play and get your reactions to this Bev Harris report where she's talking about how they tried to steal the election from Trump, but they failed.
Bev Harris has a lot of integrity. She's been a Democrat, a liberal. She exposed what Bush did, and I was bipartisan. But there was more evidence of Republican fraud than the Democrat. Both parties do it. And she said last week what Assange said. They're not going to let Trump have it. The fix is in. I'm no rocket scientist, but I've studied this. I saw places where she won by such margins, even their fake polls didn't say that. But they weren't in full control. You can't stop a landslide. I don't know Bev Harris's view on this yet. I'm going to find out, but I respect it. She is the expert globally. I'm not bragging, it's just a fact for us. People need to know how accomplished and on target she is. She's had more exposure of election fraud than everybody else combined. And that's not poo-pooing all those great folks. She is so effective. And when she was on a week and a half ago, it made national news. She released the information here on the fraction magic, these programs they found around the country that have no reason to be there but for fraud to pre-program what's going to happen at the central system. And, of course, Soros is involved, and she just said it. You know, most of the evidence is it's the Democrats, it's Soros, it looks like they're trying to do this. Well, and just a lay looking at this, being up all night covering it, having the polls for each state in front of me, it looks like they weren't in control of some areas, and that's why Trump won, because it's such a landslide. But it should have been an even bigger victory. And so it looks like that again, what Bev Harris has always said on the show for 15 years, you can't steal a landslide. Now, I'm going to find out if I'm wrong or I'm right here from her. And of course, you know, we're pretty close to this right now. We'll know more as it unfolds. But Bev Harris, I mean, is that a basically accurate what I said, or is it wrong?
Yeah, basically accurate. You did pretty good, Alex. You know, as I was watching yesterday, a few things, a few observations. One thing struck me very early in the morning yesterday is they had been planning fireworks, and then the Clinton campaign suddenly canceled their fireworks. And they did this early in the morning, which... makes me curious as to whether, you know, their intel, they already knew they were in trouble at that point, because it didn't make sense otherwise. They may have still thought they could pull it off. Another thing that struck me, though, I have seen, particularly with the Democrats, a tactic where they'll take a concentrated blue area and hold back the results for hours and hours and hours. That's, for example, when Hillary ran against Obama in the primary in Indiana.
Let's hold that right there, because we're coming up to a break. And what you just said about them holding the vote, that is something I've seen over and over again. Show us your cards. You know, you're playing a game of poker, right? And then it's always the urban areas that are under control of the Democrats, just like we saw in North Carolina, where there's a very close gubernatorial race there, where they tried to pull it out for Hillary Clinton. They let the most heavily controlled Democrat area go for another hour and a half. And then they came in with 100,000 votes for the Democrat candidate there. That's what we've seen over and over again. But this is the first time I've seen them holding back their votes and continuing to pump these things in for like 3 weeks after the election. I mean, it's absolutely insane. We're going to be right back with Owen Schroyer and Darren McBreen, and we're going to talk more about how there are other people besides just Bev Harris pointing out how this thing is going to be audited, and we're going to show you exactly how they rigged this election. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Nutt with Oren Shore and Darren McBreen. And Darren is going to be with us to the bottom of the hour. At the bottom of the hour, Alex is going to be joining us with a report about provocative actions from Turkey and NATO, still trying to provoke war with Russia. And, of course, that's something we should be very concerned about. I've had a number of discussions. I've had an interview with a Russian news source. It's amazing how optimistic they are because they've seen a loaded gun to their head, which they're still pointing at their head at this moment. But they've seen that. They felt a great sense of relief with Trump's election. So hopefully this is not something that's going to continue. We're going to get to that CNN report. I want to get your comments on this, Darren. Real quickly, though, before we go back to the news, we have, for the last day today, extended the specials that began on Black Friday and continued on through Cyber Monday. 30% off Survival Shield X2 Nascent Iodine. That was our very first product, folks, because it is so important. It's very important nutrient to have to increase your health, to help your functioning of your brain. Also, Super Male Vitality, 30% off, part of our Cyber Monday free special. Again, these are going to end today. This is the last day. Then 30 to 40% off of InfoWars Select Storable Food at InfoWarsStore.com. And finally, the biggest discount of all of them, 50% off Silver Bullet Colloidal Silver. That's at InfoWarsLife.com. This is the last day for these specials. So take a look at these specials. Massive discounts, 30%. 30 to 40%, 50% off, the big discounts across the board on these basic items that you need for your preparedness and for your family's health. Darren, talk about what you think is the overall strategy of CNN. We were talking about that during the break, but just tell the audience where you see this.
Overall strategy, I think it's a chilling effect. What they are trying to send a warning to Donald Trump, stop. You know, don't refer to InfoWars. And also, this is a message that they're continuing. It's the bullet point, the talking point about fake news. In fact, in the hit piece, they mentioned fake news.
Yeah.
And they said that basically implying that Trump gets his intelligence reports from conspiracy theory websites. So I think it's a chilling effect. It's going to backfire just like it always does and always has.
Yeah, they're putting out that narrative, as you point out. Well, look, Pence is in all these meetings, and he's getting all the intel briefings, but Trump's just hanging out on Twitter. That's not true.
Yeah.
Pence came out today and said, I've never seen anybody so engaged, instantly grasping what's going on and asking very deep questions about what's going on. He catches what these guys are saying, and he asks them very pointed questions about where this headed.
And he's smart not to trust all the intelligence reports. He doesn't necessarily trust the CIA.
That's right.
And remember, it was Harry Reid who said, he's the one that suggested that they give Trump faulty intelligence reports.
Yeah, exactly. So what's he complaining about if he thinks getting faulty?
He's like, he can't trust the intelligence reports. So, I mean, come on.
Yeah, it's going to be interesting because we have a clip they're going to play later in the show. Probably when Roger Stone joins us to talk about Trump's picks, because he's had a lot of picks. And, of course, pushing back against that, Chuck E. Schumer and Harry Reid had a press conference, and they were saying, well, we're going to have something to say about this. He's not going to get these confirmed. Well, it was Harry Reid himself who got rid of the rule of having 60 or 67 senators had to confirm these picks. He said, no, we're going to do it with just a simple majority of 51. And so I was like, okay, you made that rule. You're going to die by that rule because you're not going to be able to stop any of Trump's picks. So it's interesting to see how this thing is shaking out. Owen?
Well, I don't know what CNN's overall agenda here was. I think that I checked the Alex Jones channel on YouTube, and just a few hours after CNN ran their hit piece or promotional plug, honestly, for Alex Jones, if you want to call it that, probably benefited us more than it hurt us. Yep. We picked up a couple thousand subscribers on the Alex Jones channel. Yep. I haven't checked it this morning, but I think we're going to reach 1.9 million soon. And then maybe with the help of CNN, if they want to continue to hit piece Alex Jones, maybe we'll reach 2 million by the end of the year. So I encourage CNN to embark on this journey to try to take down or discredit Alex Jones. I encourage CNN and all of its talking heads to try to attack Alex Jones or try to separate Alex and Donald or try to have a chilling effect on Donald Trump, not to associate himself with media outlets that aren't Fox, CNN, or television approved news.
You know, it's interesting. We had that report that was a recording, a radio interview with Donald Trump on 9/11 or the day after. And the guy was asking about it. He goes, look, I'm a builder. I know that you're not going to knock down that building, especially. They bombed the foundation. That's the strongest part of the building. You're not going to knock it down with planes alone. They had to have bombs or something like that. He knew from day one something was up with that. Okay, so that's one of the reasons why he's looking for other answers to what's going on here. You're not going to fool him with that. You're not going to gaslight him. You're not going to scare him away from this. He's going to look at this stuff, and I think he's honest enough when he disagrees with somebody to say it. And he knew from the very beginning that it was a bunch of nonsense.
He's not afraid to speak out. And this reminds me a little bit. They're trying to do the same thing with the whole birther controversy, okay? They're saying that InfoWars started the birther controversy. No, Sheriff Joe Arpaio had a team of investigators check it out. It was a long, thorough investigation.
And it was actually Hillary who started it.
And then Hillary talked about it. But there was a national press conference.
Yeah.
We sent reporters there. We covered it. That's how it started.
We'll be right back. Alex Jones is going to be talking about what's going on with Turkey and NATO. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight with Owen Schroyer. And, of course, we've been talking about the CNN attack on InfoWars. You know, it was we played this quote over and over again from Hillary Clinton where she said, it's an information war and we're losing it. Well, now she's lost the election. And they're desperate to try to get this narrative back. We just saw today, Owen, that Breitbart's app was taken off of the Apple Store. They're trying every technique they can to try to get back their monopoly on information, because that's the only way that they're going to win is if we don't have a free market of ideas, because in that free market of ideas, they can't compete.
And this is the way they go about soft censorship, where they don't just have to erase Breitbart. They just have to remove Breitbart, from the biggest platform. So, you know, you have an Android, you have an Apple phone. Most people do. Okay, well, it's still on Android. But if you have Apple, unfortunately, you just can't get Breitbart news. Sorry. And then there's the other aspect of this, which I think might be the ultimate goal here, David. I think that this might be the ultimate goal. Breitbart is not verified on Twitter, okay? Now, I'm not verified on Twitter. I really don't give a damn about a Twitter verification, to be personally honest with you. But what I think their goal here is, David, to say, essentially, if you're not verified by Facebook or Twitter or whatever the mainstream platform is, if you don't have that checkbook, if you don't have that check or whatever it is, you're fake.
Yeah.
You're fake. That's how they're going to determine it. So it's not going to be up to you to verify what's real and what's fake. No. Just leave it up to Big Brother in the form of Facebook or Twitter or whatever social media platform is the biggest at that time. I think that that's their ultimate goal here. And that is the true soft censorship, to just basically keep us from being in the public eye, keep InfoWars, Breitbart, whoever
it is. They want to be the gatekeepers.
Exactly.
And in the past, when we just had three
instead
major
of you
networks,
being the gatekeeper,
yeah,
Big Brother's the gatekeeper.
In the past, when we didn't have the internet and we didn't have an energized talk radio, we had things like the Fairness Doctrine that were imposed by the FCC, which said, no, we're only going to, you know, they use the licensing, okay, which is really what they're trying to do in a way with this verification. They're trying to set up that whole licensing regime, revive that to try to establish their monopoly again, the labeling of fake news. So we understand where they're going. We understand what their strategy is. And, of course, when we look at the specifics that they were talking about in this particular report, that's the broader strategy. Their tactic was to specifically attack Trump on this election issue. And it's not just us who's saying it. And it's not just Bev Harris who is talking about election fraud. WND had a report where they talked to Catherine Engelbrecht of True the Vote. She says she's convinced that Donald Trump is correct, that there was a lot of voter fraud. And, of course, when we talked to Bev Harris, she was talking about election fraud, where they found that on some of the software, instead of having integers, which is what you would expect when you're counting votes, you're only going to have whole numbers, they set it up for floating point calculations, which would mean that they'd be able to do a mathematical transform and allocate votes. There was absolutely no reason from a programming perspective that you'd have anything other than integers, unless you were planning on doing something exactly like that, where they're summing up the votes. But this is what True the Vote said. She said that we're going to have a reliable estimate of the number of people here. And she said, we're still collecting data, and we will be for several months, but our intent is to publish a comprehensive study on the significant impact of illegal voting in all of its many forms and begin a national discussion on how voters, states, and the Trump administration can address this growing problem. We need to understand that Donald Trump won this because he had a landslide turnout, just as we've seen with the people who showing up to watch him in the public speeches that he gave, and Hillary Clinton or Bill Clinton would only couldn't fill up a small basketball stadium or something. They had massive tens of thousands of people showing up to see him. So we understand it was a landslide. We understand that's how he won, but we need to get an honest and fair election. And people even on the left, people in the Democrat Party, the grassroots, of course, the people at the top don't want this, but the grassroots should be concerned about that as well. And she said, nobody has wanted to get the answers for a long time, so questions haven't been allowed to ask. That's the paradigm that we are going to shatter. And we're going to continue talking about election fraud and the way that things can be changed. They're only using election fraud to try to discredit Donald Trump, to try to discredit InfoWars, and to try to rig this election, to try to destroy the Electoral College. Even Politico talks about how there's a hidden agenda with these people who are challenging it. Their real agenda, they said, is to get rid of the Electoral College. And we need to understand this Electoral College that is a firewall on the concentration of power into a few urban centers and the corruption that is there when they can pad these votes and continue adding votes for 3 weeks. I mean, that's the insanity of this. And that's what the Electoral College protects us from. So we need to understand that that's really the long-term strategy of these people.
It's funny, you know, how the whole Russia hacking thing just died out. Isn't that funny? It just died out. What happened to that? I thought Russia was hacking the election. No, but here's how my day went.
Well, they're talking about that in Germany now because they know that Merkel is going to lose. So they're already starting
with
the Russians.
Yeah, they got to build up. They're going to do it in France with Le Pen and probably the whole
exactly,
nine yards.
Yeah.
And you know what? Globalism is losing around the world. But David, you come to my desk today. You say, hey, Owen, I want to have you on the show. We have to combat the real fake news here saying that voter fraud doesn't exist. We have to hit them right in the head with all the evidence. And I'm just sitting here like, oh, my God, I've covered this ad nauseum. I've done dozens of segments working for InfoWars covering voter fraud. Like, this shouldn't even be going on. And, David, you sit here and you say, well, we deserve to live in a country with a fair election. Absolutely you do. But you know what? It goes beyond that, folks. All citizens of planet Earth live in a land of confusion right now. We deserve to live in a world where we know what the hell's going on, okay? I've got stories here, stack after stack, of local CBS affiliates doing independent investigations and finding mass amounts of voter fraud, okay? But then, just 2 days ago, CNN News or CBS News National, Donald Trump, citing no evidence, claims millions of people voted illegally. Your own network, your own independent investigations is covering voter fraud, and then you're going to print out a story saying Donald Trump cites no evidence. Why do I have to live in a land of confusion? Why do people have to live in a land of confusion, David? And ultimately, I think that's what we are trying to stop at InfoWars. You can say whatever you want about us. You can put whatever monikers you want about us. We might even get it wrong sometimes, but I'll tell you what. We are sick and tired of living in the land of confusion. I want to know what the hell is going on. I want to know why dead people are voting. I want to know why Donald Trump is claiming millions. I want to know why CBS is saying that there's no evidence and then their own independent investigations find evidence. That's what I want to figure out. That's what we at InfoWars want to figure out, David.
Well, that's the disconnect between the local reporters who are actually reporting news that happened and then the propaganda reporting, which is like what we used to beam into the former Soviet Union with Voice of America. Remember, it's just a few years ago they said, hey, we're going to make it legal to do that same kind of propaganda reporting by the government into the United States. And, of course, they don't really need that. They've got their own false media. But you're talking about the narrative about the Russians rigging the election and everything. Let's talk about what's really going on. I just got put on my desk here. Twitter says it would consider banning Donald Trump's account. Okay, there you go. Well, you know what, Twitter? If you just want to shut down your entire business model, you do that. Donald Trump is probably the best thing that happened to Twitter.
Isn't Twitter's stock like dying already? I mean, you already banned Milo.
Oh, this is crazy. They would ban Donald Trump's account. Yeah, this is going to be the end of these people because the more obvious they become about this. First of all, he put Twitter on the map. Everybody started talking about Twitter. I got more involved with Twitter, frankly, because of Donald Trump. I wasn't really very involved with Twitter because I thought it was a great way for people to interact. And I like the way the news feed is there. But you know what? They don't have a monopoly on information. And they're going to lose what they do have. They're delegitimize what they're doing if they ban Donald Trump. They're going to really shoot themselves in the head. This is just amazing.
These people hate Donald Trump so much, and they don't even understand they're handing him the world on a silver platter.
Yeah.
Don't you understand discredited fake news that all Donald Trump has to do is start his own news network and he defeats you? Don't you understand that all Donald Trump has to do is start his own social network and he defeats you? I mean, you are handing the entire world on a platter to Donald Trump and you don't even realize it. That's how blinded you are by your hate for
the
man.
That's amazing. That's amazing. But of course, the fake news was about the Russian involvement, but there are very provocative things that are happening. I want to get Alex Jones report about something that's been very provocative statement by Turkey's Erdogan, talking about how they're really going to war with Syria and Russia. Here's that report.
Massive wars are something that most people never believe could actually happen until it actually happens. Like a Mount Vesuvius erupting or a Mount St. Helens. Those sleeping mountains seem like they're dead until they awaken and rain down fiery death. Most geopolitical analysts believe that the world is closer to a new world war than ever before. Trump being elected obviously took the defense condition from 2 and 3 back to 5, back to the lowest condition, and there is some detente going on. But Erdogan, who has had all sorts of problems in Turkey, he basically staged his last election, that's admitted. There's been attempts to overthrow him, there's been multiple coup attempts, everybody knows about that. He came out yesterday, and this has gotten no attention in Western press. Michael Snyder wrote about a free economic collapse blog, it's on Infowars.com. And if you read his headline, it's not sensational, it's what's happening. Turkey has declared war on Syria. Does this mean that World War III is about to erupt in the Middle East? Now, let me explain what this really means. It actually means war in the Middle East between NATO and Russia has been declared by NATO, but it doesn't mean that that physical war has started yet. But it's kind of like the horse's gates open, and the buzzer sounds, and the gates open. So he's a NATO member. There's a defense pact with all the NATO nations, North Atlantic Treaty Organization, set up for World War II, that if one nation attacks, they will all back that nation, or if one of those nations is attacked, they will back that nation. So you've got Turkey, gateway to the West, basically playing chicken with the world or holding the world hostage. He came out 2 days ago and said, if you don't accept millions more migrants and give me billions more dollars and give me more power in the EU, I'm going to just let millions of more Middle Easterners come in out of Syria. All the folks from the Middle East that basically invaded that country, part of the five-year-old Arab Spring that our government's financed openly. So the West starts all this. Turkey's involved. They've been attacking Syria for 5 years with aircraft and with bombers and with artillery and with tanks. But now, this is in the mainline state-run Turkish news. I mean, I didn't just believe this article. I went and looked it up. They've rolled in with tanks, fighter bombers in the north, and they say, quote, we are going to overthrow the tyrant Bashar al-Assad, and has declared war on Syria officially. Now, he does that because that triggers NATO. Now, who's got a defense agreement with Syria? And who's been invited in by Syria? And who didn't start this 5 years ago? Russia. I'm not picking sides here, folks. This is crazy. Russia has a lot of troops on the ground. They've got several air bases. They have been carpet bombing al-Qaeda, and they've turned the tide. They're kicking al-Qaeda, now known as ISIS, out of the country. They're losing on every front. That's in the news. U.S. forces are finally being allowed, because Obama's been embarrassed into it, to engage on the ground and push out the rest of the ISIS people. We have thousands of U.S. soldiers there, most of them special forces. What is it, like 10 of them died? Just died in the last few weeks? I mean, it was like 6 in 1 week. I mean, this is a major war. We should get Colonel Schaefer on this week or next week to talk more about it as much as he can. And Erdogan, who's been caught buying the oil they stole out of Syria, and his son, the rest of it, working with ISIS, he's now really pissed, threatening even bigger migrant floods into Europe, threatening to join Russia 2 weeks ago, then pulling back, now threatening war with Russia. A state of war between NATO and Russia has basically been declared. If you look at the treaties, and that's exactly how the London Independent and others a few months ago said that this could lead to World War III and is the biggest tinderbox in the world. If they use the example, Turkey was just get another plane shot down and then respond, or if Turkey was to invade, and then the Russians have to back up the Syrians, which they've said they'll do. And again, I go back to this. I wouldn't be saying do this if Syria was run by bad people, because it's their own nation. I don't want to start World War III. We're not an empire. We're not supposed to be. Even, though Karl Rove says we are. And we're, quote, history's actors. Okay, we're history's actors backing radical jihadis out of Saudi Arabia, taking over Africa and the Middle East, and menacing Russia. This is totally immoral. And the West started all this. Then when their Somalis and Syrians and others stab people at grocery stores and shopping malls and colleges, we're told they're not jihadis. And don't say that or you're a racist. It's all about breaking our will and conditioning us to put up with anything. So here's your real headline. NATO is now in a declared war with Russia. It's worse than Turkey has declared war on Syria. Because when Turkey declares war on Syria, that activates the defense pacts above. That's a fact. Now, the New York Times will call that fake news. The same ones that lied us into war with Iraq when it was Saudi Arabia, bare minimum, hit us on 9/11. The same ones that told us, you know, that Hillary, we had a 97% chance of winning. No, no. The main analyst agreed that this is now a state of war, okay? And that there would be this type of event that could trigger it at any time. So let's get some attention on this. Let's get this covered in the news. Call your newspapers, folks. Call your TV stations, your congressmen and women, and say, do your job. Pull Turkey back from this. We've got nuclear weapons, by the way, in Turkey at two different air bases, and we've given them so many weapons. They've got one of the largest militaries. I know they're in the top 10, folks. I mean, they're big. And they are the former center of the Ottoman Empire. Turks will fight. God, look at World War I. This is a serious situation. Wish we would have kept Turkey Christian. Constantinople. Oh, but the religion of peace took it over. We're not migrating and taking over their countries. They're taking over our countries. And we're paying for it for over 1,000 years. Nothing against Muslims in general. But man, I'm not trying to conquer you. So stop trying to conquer us. And he says that. He says we're going to conquer you with migration. Go read the articles on Infowars.com and also hit your knees and pray to God that we continue to have detente and push back from what is the brink of a chain reaction that could lead to a wider worldwide war. Because the Russians hit back, NATO hits back, and then it goes from unconventional asymmetrical warfare to conventional warfare, and then it goes to nuclear warfare. That's how this works. It escalates from ground war and guerrilla war to conventional mainline armies, and then it gets, in a matter of days usually, escalated, experts believe, up into thermonuclear war. Infowars.com/show. Censorship is massively intensifying against us and others. So please don't take these videos and articles for granted. We don't take you for granted. We're fighting the globalists here in America for our own sovereignty, and we're fighting to stop the globalists from starting World War III. So this is a new kind of war. It's an information war that we're winning. We've got to use the info war and truth, our secret weapon, against the globalists, because they want a global crisis ahead of the economic collapse they're engineering. And that's very, very clear. So we are in incredible times. And Donald Trump's right. The answer to this is Americanism, not globalism.
Absolutely, because it's globalism that has given us these ideas of regime change, Owen. And ISIS is our surrogate in that area. And, of course, today they just announced, the Syrian government announced that it liberated a major road going into Aleppo so they can now bring aid in there. Is it a good thing to have ISIS in control of that area where they're cutting people's heads off, committing those kinds of atrocities in the areas that they control? Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight here with Owen Schroer. And, of course, in the next hour we're going to be joined by Roger Stone. And Owen, he's going to have a lot to say about the cabinet picks, the transition team. There's been a lot of picks in the last 24 to 48 hours. One of the things he said also about the attack on the Electoral College and them trying to switch the people who are going to go to the Electoral College just as they tried to take the delegates to the RNC and say, well, okay, this is what the people voted for, but we want you to override that. These are the same people who now are vociferously calling for direct popular elections, except when the people make the wrong mistake, as they say. And when the people make the wrong mistake, they want these people to undo that for them. And Roger Stone said, well, we're tracking this intensely. In an email, he said he's convinced that this is going to fail, but it is the dying gasp of the established order. So he's going to be joining us in the next hour. And in the fourth hour, I'm sure he's going to have a lot to say about these pushback against the actual election results, as well as what's on the transition team. Before we get back to the news, I just want to remind people that today is going to be the last day for these extended specials that began with Black Friday. And we've had massive sales going through Black Friday, Cyber Monday. We've had 30% off Survival Shield X2 Nascent Iodine, 30% off Super Male Vitality. We have 30 to 40% off select storable foods. That's a 25-year life on these made in the USA, non-GMO foods, the best packaging you're going to find anywhere, and the best discounts that you're going to find anywhere, 30 to 40% off, and 50% off colloidal silver. a great time to stock up on that. It doesn't ever go bad. Okay, this is a perfect time to stock up on this. We've extended these sales, but today is the very last day. So 30% off of nascent iodine and super male vitality, 50% off colloidal silver bullet, and 30 to 40% off select storable foods. This is the last day we've extended that. Now, Owen, you were just talking about the cabinet picks, and of course, there was the dinner last night with Mitt Romney. You were saying during the break that Mitt Romney was unfortunately looking very happy when he got out of that meeting.
I'm just trying to figure out how a guy like Mitt Romney operates. Just months ago, he was calling Donald Trump a con man. Well, of course, it was, what, I guess 4 years ago, he was saying how great Trump was when he wanted him to endorse him for president. Then he comes out and he says he's a total con man, he's a fraud, you know, this, that, and the other thing, character assassinates him. Now Trump offers him an olive branch, sends him to dinner, and here he back is. He's Trump's great. I had a great meeting. What a productive meeting it was. I'm looking forward to talking to Donald again. So I just don't understand what is going on with Mitt Romney. But as far as Donald Trump is concerned, he appoints Mitch McConnell's wife. Mm-hmm. He's got Goldman Sachs now getting an appointment. And, you know, I don't know what his plan is for
Mitt
Romney.
Maybe two for Goldman Sachs.
And maybe
yeah.
two.
Yeah.
Who knows what he's going to do with Mitt Romney. But this isn't really draining the swamp. I mean, this is not the draining of the swamp that I think the American people wanted. Now, we're going to keep a close eye on Donald Trump. That's just what we do here at InfoWars.com. But it'll be interesting to see. I mean, I'm just trying to figure out what move he's really making here with Mitt Romney. What is behind the curtain here? Because, you know, he didn't just, we've heard what he did with the media. You know, he didn't just let Mitt Romney come into his office and didn't give him a tongue lashing.
Yeah, I was hoping that instead of frog legs, it was going to be crow on the menu. But I guess he's trying to put out an olive branch to the Republican establishment. I thought he did enough with Reince Priebus, but of course, he's the one that is making the moves. And as they say, it was Bismarck that said, in politics, you don't want to see the laws being made any more than you want to see how sausage is made. And unfortunately, we're now seeing how sausages have been made because we have this 24/7 media. They've even got a TV camera set up on the elevator there in Trump Tower. So we're looking at all this and we're trying to read the tea leaves. We're trying to look at this. It's difficult. I think we need to give him the benefit of the doubt when we look at his pick for Treasury Secretary Mnuchin, even though he's got a Goldman Sachs background that's strong in that. He did come out today and he went down the list of Trump's priorities. That's very important that they're on the same page. I don't know if Mitt Romney is or not. We're going to be talking about that with Roger Stone in the next hour. Stay with us. We'll be right back.
Forgive me. I have scanned. The government wants you to view them as God. To do that, they attempt to reproduce the very attributes of God. God-verment wants you to see it as omniscient, knowing everything about you. Omnipresent, its constant presence on the media, cameras watching you everywhere, on your phone, on your computer. And as omnipotent, presenting itself as all-powerful and irresistible. This is why the police are becoming increasingly brutal and publicly getting away with it.
This is the fog for what I would liken to specter these global corporations to just take over.
Yeah, that's right. And what it really does is it gives them all that power. Having all that knowledge, then they now know how or who they have to deal with in their societies to be able to control the outcomes. That's really what I've been saying for several years, is that their whole idea is population control. And in order to do that, you have to have knowledge about the population, and that's what this is giving them.
A security clearance to even be able to function and have a job, even in the private sector. I mean, this is beyond Hitler's best dreams, isn't it, sir?
Oh, it's well beyond all, Orwell's in 1984, too. I mean, it's getting into not only the things that you're doing and who you're working with and who you do those things with, but also what you're thinking. And that's really where this is heading.
And then openly blackmailing you to submit and do everything you're told, or they will lower your social score so you can't operate in society and can't travel.
Yeah, and if they can't get to you, they'll get to somebody you care about, just like the KGB did.
On December 1st, 2016, the spy state will slip a Fourth Amendment violating procedure into the Federal Rules of Criminal Procedure. Notice the term procedure. According to an article released by the Electronic Frontier Foundation back in April, the amendment to Rule 41 isn't procedural at all. It creates new avenues for government hacking that were never approved by Congress. Congress, the proposal would grant a judge the ability to issue a warrant to remotely access, search, seize, or copy data when the district where the media or information is located has been concealed through technological means, or when the media are on protected computers that have been damaged without authorization and are located in five or more districts. It would grant this authority to any judge in any district where activities related to the crime may have occurred. The first part of this change would grant authority to practically any judge to issue a search warrant to remotely access, seize, or copy data relevant to a crime when a computer was using privacy protective tools to safeguard one's location. All of those using a VPN service, or even those denying GPS location of their devices through a map app, for example, are subject to being implicated by the little-known procedural amendment. And while the federal hackers are hacking your device or computer with malware, malicious hackers with far better experience hacking botnet devices will be hacking the federal government, causing any and all of your private data to be exposed simply because you were exercising your right to privacy, which is apparently a crime now. And all of it done with zero public debate.
2.5 weeks ago, it was discovered that there were 17 cell towers in the southwest, the southeast actually, that were fake cell towers. They were, rather than transmitting phone calls directly to who you were talking to, they were planting software on the devices that you were using to connect. Well, you don't have to actually put a cell tower beside the road or on top of a mountain. You can put it in the back of your car and put an antenna on the top of your car and be anywhere. And they look and sound exactly like real cell towers. These devices are manufactured by the Harris Corporation. They're the only company that manufactures them. And they have a contract with all of their customers saying that the customer cannot talk about where they bought the equipment from or the fact that they own this equipment.
Google was founded by the CIA and NSA on record 14 years ago. Apple is really a CIA front. Microsoft is pre-CIA. It's an IBM front that actually created the CIA. You might want to look into that. Who set up IBM? What its goal was? World domination, master race, eugenics. IBM was probably the main funder of Hitler. If you're a new listener, that sounds crazy. Just please look it up. Okay?
John Bound for Infowars.com.
Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, but I'm not going to be your guest host this hour and the next. Our guest host is going to be Roger Stone with Stone Cold Truth, and I'm anxious to see what he's going to talk about. He's got several guests that are lined up, and of course, there's been a lot of news. In the last 24 hours, we've seen Donald Trump's pick for Treasury, his pick for Commerce. We've seen his pick for Health and Human Services, which is going to have a big effect on Obamacare. So we've got the economy and how the Trump administration is shaping up to move the economy and jobs forward. Is that on the same track that Trump is going to be on? I think it is, but we'll see what Roger Stone has to say about this, what his take is on these issues. I'm anxious to see what he's going to be talking about. Roger, thank you for joining us.
David, thank you very much. Let's face it, we have big shoes to fill here, filling in for Alex Jones.
Yes.
We're going to talk about a lot of exciting stuff today. I'm going to talk to St. John Hunt, the author, researcher, poet, musician, but also the son of legendary CIA operative E. Howard Hunt, about Fidel Castro and the country's history with Castro. We're going to talk to Jack Posobiec about security during Donald Trump's upcoming inauguration. We're going to expose the fraud of the Wisconsin recount, the fronting of Jill Stein for Hillary Clinton in the last dying gasp by Hillary, in my opinion, to stay out of prison. We're going to visit with Sean Stone, author, filmmaker, son of legendary filmmaker Oliver Stone, about his projects. We're going to visit with Kate Koptenko, who is a 16-year-old prodigy who made music videos that helped propel the election of Donald Trump. So we've got a full agenda. And I'm just delighted to be here again at Infowars.com.
Oh, that's great. You know, when you were talking about Wisconsin, what is your take, Roger, on Pennsylvania? Because we saw this report. It was up on the Drudge Report. It was a quote from someone at the Board of Elections or the Secretary of State in Pennsylvania. I think it was actually the office saying that Jill Stein had missed the deadline to file for a recount by a full week. I mean, isn't that decisive? And if that's the case, even if they play their games and keep Wisconsin and Michigan out of the Electoral College, he's a 280 if he keeps Pennsylvania. What is your take on that? Is that going to hold? Why are we, you know, why is the, I know why the press is still talking about Jill Stein, and I know why Jill Stein is still doing this, but I mean, isn't that really the reality? Haven't they shut her down with that?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, first of all, the Wisconsin recount started yesterday with testimony from the Democrats. And it's ironic. This sounds vaguely familiar, David. They're saying these computerized voting machines can be hacked.
Yeah. They, that was a conspiracy theory.
They attacked me when I said that as a conspiracy theorist. Yeah. You may also recall when Donald Trump wasn't willing to readily endorse the outcome of the election without knowing whether it had been fairly and honestly conducted. He was savagely attacked for tearing at the fabric of our democratic society, for undermining the underpinnings of our democratic system. Now, of course, Hillary Clinton is doing exactly that.
The hypocrisy is pretty rich, isn't it? They think they can flush that all down the memory hole and it's just going to go away. I mean, we don't even have to go back and look at their statements on the internet. It was just a couple of weeks. We all remember that. We don't have that bad of memory.
Yeah, it's really extraordinary. Basically, what we learned yesterday in Wisconsin is the Democrats have nothing. They have a theory. It's the same theory that I put forward months ago, but can only be tested by comparing actual machine results with exit polling, of which, of course, they have none. So it's all conjecture. It's all based on a claim that the voting machines and the paper ballots are not the same. The voting pattern is not the same. Well, of course, they're not the same. Demographics explain this. The computerized voter machines are in urban areas. The paper ballots are more likely to be in rural areas. The fact that rural areas will vote differently than the big Democratic urban areas is not surprising. So this is a fraud. It's a waste of the taxpayers' time. And later on in the show, I'm going to reveal a petition that folks can sign to knock off the phony recounts, because without Pennsylvania, as you point out, and without Michigan, where I think they are unlikely to succeed, they have bupkis. They have nothing.
Yeah. Yeah. Of course, you saw this coming. You started Stop the Steal a long time ago. You knew that there were going to be if it had been a real close election. And it really isn't. You knew that they were going to pull these kind of shenanigans. So this is nothing new, but it needs to be pushed back against. And we do really need real election reform, and we need to be able to have the ability to audit this stuff. That's why we talked about what's happening here in Texas, where they shut this down with the electronic voting machines, where there is no capability to go back and get those records. That's a real problem, and people on both sides of the aisle need to understand that and do something about it. But that's not what their goal is in this, and we all understand what their goal is.
Agreed. Great to be back here at InfoWars.
Well, I'm going to let you take this, Roger. Thank you for joining us, and thank you for guest hosting. I'm really anxious to hear these guests that you've got.
Me too. So we are going to revisit the entire question of the recount. We're going to look very closely at the legal process in Wisconsin and Michigan and Pennsylvania a little later in the show. I believe coming up, I have St. John Hunt, who is a very interesting fellow in his own right. St. John is an author, a poet, a musician, a singer-songwriter, and, of course, he is the son of the legendary CIA agent E. Howard Hunt, later infamously one of the Watergate burglars. St. John joins us today because he has a special knowledge and history regarding Fidel Castro and this country's involvement with Castro since the 50s. Now, it is interesting to me that the mainstream media continues to try to depict Fidel Castro as some kind of dashing, romantic, modern day Robin Hood, when in fact he was a murderous thug, a mass murderer for that matter, an oppressor of Christians and gays and others, and that Castro was running and is still running under his brother's regime, a gulag, where there is no freedom of speech, while there is no freedom of assembly, while there is no freedom of religion, while there is no freedom of expression. So joining me, hopefully on the line, is St. John Hunt. St. John, welcome to InfoWars.
Thank you, Roger. It's good to be back at InfoWars, and thank you for having me, and thank all your listeners as well. I just wanted to add something about your take on Castro, and of course, I did a little fact-checking myself. There's an article in the Wall Street Journal recently called Counting Castro's Victims, and it's based on the work of Professor Armando Lago, and he places a number approaching 100,000 deaths, murders as a result of, direct result of Fidel Castro's oppressive regime there. So, you know, to those people that have glorified and somewhat romanticized Castro as a, you know, seeker of truth and freedom and, you know, some sort of visionary, he may have been that at times, certainly early on in his career when he was liberating Cuba from the oppressive regime that the Batista had been running there, which was working hand in hand with the American mob and the government. You know, he may have had some romanticism attached to him at that point, but very quickly he realized that to maintain control and power, he went on a murderous rampage. And by President Obama recognizing Cuba, he basically recognized a mass murder regime. So it's funny how a little island like this could have such a huge influence on American political history, and certainly it influenced my family. In 1959, my father, as a CIA agent, went to Cuba undercover to assess the regime there, and he came back and chaired a meeting which was put together by Tracy Barnes, of the CIA, to establish a task force to assassinate Castro. At the meeting, of course, my father was there, David Atlee Phillips, and a number of other well-known CIA assets and agents. And my father was the first CIA official to put forth that an invasion of Cuba had to coincide with the assassination of Fidel Castro. So a group was put together, presided over by Richard Nixon, who got funds from George Bush Sr. To put together this group. They called it Operation 40 because in the beginning there were 40 members, later expanded to 70 and perhaps more than that. Some of the names of these assassins and operatives of Operation 40 read like a who's who of American history. Ted Shackley, David Morales, Barry Seal, Porter Goss. You know, it goes on and on and on. Some of the Watergate burglars were members. But as Frank Sturgis he put it so well, he stated that Operation 40 would, upon orders, assassinate either members of the military or the political parties of the foreign countries that you were going to infiltrate or invade, and if necessary, some of your own members who were suspected of being foreign agents. So this was an off-the-shelf CIA operation which had assassination as its primary focus. And of course, we know now that the CIA made many, many attempts with and without the mafia to get rid of Fidel Castro. Operation 40, of course, didn't stop with the assassinations of Castro, but went on to be involved in many, many other assassination attempts. Some were successful and some weren't.
All right, St. John Hunt, thanks for joining us here on InfoWars. Welcome back. I'm Roger Stone, filling the very big shoes of Alex Jones today on InfoWars. I want to bring your attention to the extension of the Cyber Monday free speech special that's been offered here at the InfoWars.com store. Now, you can achieve two great things here. First of all, they have their special male virility vitality formula, which is 30% off during this very special sale. Now, the revolution isn't free. It costs money to keep this beacon of free speech, InfoWars, in business. So you can achieve two things. You can strike back at those who want to restrict the internet, those who want to gag free speech by libertarian and liberty-oriented organs like Infowars.com, Breitbart, Daily Caller, and others, and you can help finance what we're doing here. At the same time, you can take a proven formula, which has literally hundreds of endorsements from satisfied users. So it's a win-win for both sides. I really strongly urge you to go to the Infowars.com store and grab the Super Male Vitality Formula. I don't think you'll be disappointed. So we are now going into a crucial phase of the Trump administration. And there is, of course, the massive struggle over who will be Secretary of State. We're going to come back and talk about that in a little bit. But the president has made some new appointments that I think are pivotal. Steve Mnuchin at Treasury, although he has a background at Goldman Sachs, he is without any question a Trump loyalist. What this means to me is that the Trump economic plan that was laid out by Larry Kudlow and Steve Moore and other pro-growth advocates in their assistance to President-elect Donald Trump is highly likely to be implemented without bureaucratic interference. Mnuchin is really, in many ways, a close friend and an extension of the president-elect. And therefore, I don't expect there to be any dilution of Trumpism when it comes to the economy. Now, as David Knight said in the opening segment, that really is the keystone of the Trump reforms. Without a growing, in fact, a surging economy, it will be very difficult for President Trump to fix the country's other problems, rebuild our national defense, renegotiate these enormous globalist trade deals that have ruined the job market in the United States, as he has stated numerous times, to overhaul our immigration system. The wall is going to cost money. Money that our government doesn't have today. When Hillary Clinton went off to bomb Libya, we had to borrow $1 million to pay for the bombs. That's how tight the federal treasury is. I also think Donald Trump is the only president in recent memory who may actually have some prospect for cutting federal spending. That's because he is not beholden to any particular special interest. He doesn't owe anyone. Not the bankers, not Wall Street, not the lobbyists, not the special pleaders. He will be the first president in my memory whose only criteria will be, is it good for the American people? Now, every Republican candidate for president that I have supported and worked for has talked about cutting federal spending. Sadly, it's been campaign rhetoric. No president has shrunk the size and scope of the federal government. I think Donald Trump may be the first one who can do so. I do want to say, with the inauguration coming up, I strongly urge you to go to the Infowars.com store and get your Trump is my president t-shirt. This is going to be the t-shirt to wear in Washington on January 20th. There's going to be a limited number of these. They're going to end up in the Smithsonian as part of the overall Trump revolution. So believe me, grab yours now while they're still available. I'm giving them away for Christmas presents, to be honest with you. And if you have a chance and you haven't done so yet, you could also grab the iconic Trump rape, the iconic Clinton rape t-shirt. This is the t-shirt that Alex Jones and I use to break through the mainstream media blackout on Bill Clinton's real record as a sexual predator. Thanks for joining us here at InfoWars. Welcome back to InfoWars. This is Roger Stone. I'm filling in today for Alex Jones while he takes a few very well-deserved days off, having been an MVP in the Trump revolution, having been Trump from the very beginning. So he is getting a well-deserved rest. Now I want to talk about the inauguration, because I know many of the Trump activists around the country are very anxious to attend. And I would urge you to send your name and address and your email address to defenddonald.com. We are assembling the names of those who wish to go to the inauguration. Now, to be clear, this will allow you to purchase tickets for some of the public inauguration events. The actual inauguration, the swearing in, is handled by the U.S. Congress, and tickets to that are controlled by the U.S. Congress. And after the cabinet and the Congress and the foreign dignitaries and the other federal officials are seated, there's about 20% left for the American people. Write your congressman if you want to attend, but frankly, good luck. Now, our next guest, Jack Posobiec, was a very key activist in the Trump Citizens for Trump effort. He's a security expert, and he joins us now to talk to us about the inauguration. Now, many of you may recall that Barack Obama walked the parade route, and of course, D.C. was his kind of town. There is some question as to whether President-elect Donald Trump will walk or ride, and the other necessary security procedures. So, Jack, why don't you take it away?
Hi, good afternoon, Roger, and thanks so much for having me on today. So, a lot of talk has been going on between the Secret Service and the transition team regarding Mr. Trump's personal safety, or I should say President-elect Trump's personal safety, for the inauguration. We know that this event has been targeted by George Soros. We know that they plan specifically to disrupt the organization of the inauguration and disrupt the inaugural festivities, and are actually calling it as such. George W. Bush, if some will recall, did not actually take the walk during the procession from the Congressional building all the way down to the White House on Pennsylvania Avenue. George W. Bush instead rode in the car, the presidential limousine, until just about the point where he got to the White House, stepped out, and then walked in the final bit of the way. So there's been some discussion as to whether the threat level to Mr. Trump is going to be similar to that, and whether or not he should walk that or ride in the car. And personally, I'm in the position of he should ride in the car. With what we're seeing from George Soros, as well as Al Sharpton, calls for organizations, tens of thousands of protesters will be descending onto D.C. They're holding planning meetings as we speak, looking at ways to infiltrate security. They're also suing to block Donald Trump from having bleachers in front of the Trump Hotel for the guests to simply watch the parade, because that is the level to which they're taking their disruption.
I do want to make one correction, Jack. I had the email address wrong. It is defendtrump.com. So if you're interested in participating in the inauguration, if you plan to go to Washington, and we urge you to do so and to wear your Trump is my president T-shirt, go to defendtrump.com. I apologize. I had that wrong. It's defendtrump.com. Jack, this morning I saw an email from a group that appears to be on the cusp of disrupting the inauguration. And they openly say they want to shut down Trump's swearing in, or at a minimum, drive him inside so that it is done behind closed doors. It appears to me that they are openly, it's called Disrupt J20, is this radical group. They appear to be planning widespread violence and lawlessness at the inauguration. What's your take?
This is absolutely correct. And this is the same type of really fascist type tactics that George Soros has used in parts of Eastern Europe to push his agenda. It is an anti-democratic agenda, and don't let anyone tell you otherwise. They are trying to interfere with America's process of democracy, and they are looking at ways to interject themselves in any way, shape, or form. They are using essentially George Soros's brown shirts to go and disrupt the democratic proceeding, the inauguration. And now if people want to go and demonstrate, that is perfectly fine. And that is their First Amendment protected rights, as we were all reminded yesterday about the vigorous discussion about the First Amendment. However, disrupting what is essentially an official process of our democratic system is certainly not protected by the U.S. Constitution. They are calling for this violence in an attempt not only to delegitimize Donald Trump, but to delegitimize the entire democratic system of the United States. This is what George Soros wants, and this is what he's wanted from the start. And he's put millions of dollars behind this, and millions of dollars are going to go into these groups as well.
Now, there's been some discussion of holding a counter demonstration in support of President-elect Trump. This is an idea I really like. And I know you and I and others have had scouts out looking for a legal location where we could actually do such a pro-Trump demonstration, if you will. And of course, the U.S. Park Service is not, which controls most of the real estate in and around the District of Columbia, at least the public spaces, doesn't seem to be very keen on having us there. Now we are forced to look at locations perhaps across the river in Virginia, but close to the riverbank, so that we can also be seen and heard, and we can demonstrate that we are the silent majority, that we are the forgotten Americans, that the average Americans support President Trump, and they're calling foul on these paid-for Soros-sponsored demonstrations. How does the outlook appear to you in terms of finding a viable location?
For finding a viable location, it is tricky. As you said, the National Park Service is shutting down essentially permits, legal permits, that usually are submitted within 1 year of the inauguration. We were told that it would be perfectly fine to get one of these permits, and that 84%, again, we were told, of the parade route as well as the inaugural festivities would be available to us. However, just like we saw in Cleveland at the RNC, what we are told and how things work in practice are two very different things. So I think that just like that event that we held in Cleveland with Citizens for Trump, we can go out to the banks of the Potomac River in Virginia. There are numerous parks there. There are numerous places that are actually outside of the National Park Service. We would then be dealing with the government of the state of Virginia, which is a completely different entity from the National Park Service, and simply applying for a permit to hold a demonstration in support of Donald Trump, as well as in support of the United States democratic process, and really show the American people and show the cameras that we will stand up to George Soros, and we will not let him disrupt these inaugural festivities as they've set foot. Their jackboot troops are not the same as what we're looking for in terms of the ordinary, regular Americans who want to see the process of democracy and the transition of power conducted in a smooth and fair manner.
All right, Jack Posobiec, I hear, by the way, that you may be under consideration for a job at the White House. I'm happy to add my recommendation to that application, because I know what an effective job you did working for Citizens for Trump. So thanks for joining us here at InfoWars.
Thank you much, Roger.
This would be a good time for me to remind you that the InfoWars Select Storable Foods are now at a 30 to 40% discount based on the Black Friday preparedness sale that's been announced. Now, these select storable foods have a shelf life of 25 years. I myself have a storage of these products because one never knows about national disasters or political disasters. I don't expect political instability under President Trump, but I do think it is wise to be prepared. These food prices are going up around the world, and now is the time to get started storing these shelf-life foods that last you 25 years in case of dire emergency. You owe it to your family to go to the InfoWars.com store now and get your select storable foods. Now we're joined by an old friend of mine, Chris Doerwerth, a former Republican state legislator in the state of Florida, and now a Republican leader, someone who was very much out front for Donald Trump in the last election. Thanks for joining us here at InfoWars, Chris Doerwerth.
Thanks, Roger. How you been?
Doing great, thank you. So the first and most important thing I want to ask you, Chris, is Florida. Florida was, really one of the absolute key states in Donald Trump's election, and we all saw the polls leading to Election Day that showed him, by and large, narrowly trailing there. And he did not seem to achieve the vote levels in the southern counties of Miami-Dade, Broward, and Palm Beach that would appear to be necessary for a statewide Republican to win. Yet, he won. Now, I think he won for one reason, because of the superb campaign leadership of Susie Wiles, who ran the campaign for Donald Trump, and one of the most capable women that I know. But I know you have your finger on some of the big picture trends. What really happened in the Sunshine State?
Well, and that really is the big question. Like you, everyone read that if Trump loses Florida, the race will be over, but we'll know by 7:30, and that'll be the end of everything. And then, you know, if the initial reports started coming in that there were these huge deficits in Broward County, and Orange County was performing terribly, and, you know, there was this sort of speculation that, oh, dear, here we go. And then as the vote numbers would file in, you would just see that the spaces between those urban areas were just overwhelmingly turning out for Trump. And more importantly, the other side really wasn't turning out. And that was really the story of the race. And, you know, pretty early on, we had a pretty good feeling that this was going to happen, you know, that we were going to be able to carry the state of Florida for Trump and to deliver the electoral votes. And it is basically impossible for a Republican to be elected president of the United States without having the state of Florida. And, you know, you mentioned Susie Wiles. You know, Susie is beyond a rock star at this stuff. I mean, she ran the campaign for Rick Scott, who was, you know, little known before he beat Bill McCollum and then defeated Alex Fink to become governor, and then to take this the Trump race, to be told by everybody that you just have no chance at this and deliver that state. It's just really a testimony to her and the campaign team they put together.
Yeah, no, it really is. It's almost a political miracle, particularly given the spending levels for the Clinton campaign. I mean, I think nationally, my very best estimation between the Clinton campaign, the Clinton super PACs, and the various legal and illegal operations of George Soros, I think they come pretty close to $2 billion. At the same time, I saw the Trump campaign spending, including the super PACs, independent super PACs and other friendlies, probably close to $280 million, a giant disparity. Now, in a super state like Florida, where television advertising is pivotal, could you feel that difference on watching television, listening to the radio? Was it palpable?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, first and foremost, if you have the audacity to watch a news program in the last week or two before the campaign, any sort of primetime news, it was just absolute inundation from the Hillary Clinton campaign. You know, Trump had his presence. I mean, it was a small fraction. And the numbers that you said, I think it would be about 14%, and it certainly felt that way. And I think at one point in time, I was watching the NBC News affiliate here, and they had the Hillary commercial, the same one on, back to back to back, three times. So we're watching this, and at the same time, you know, Trump was his campaign was more unorthodox, and I think you and I could probably both agree that 150 or 200 years from now, historians studying American electoral processes and federal government and what happened, this will be the race they talk about. I mean, it's a fascinating sort of rearrangement of the deck chairs and to see these Rust Belt states. And I got to tell you one thing. I mean, we haven't had a chance to get to this yet, but I'm looking forward to happy hour today because I want to celebrate these 134 Democrats that put Nancy Pelosi back into the leader position. I think the definition of insanity is often lamented as doing the same thing and expecting a different outcome. And I got to tell you something, you know, by secret ballot, they decided to maintain course, which, you know, really does kind of make you wonder if they learned anything from the whole experience.
Well, Chris, I know that happy hour is one of your specialties, and I look forward to joining you for that. I know when you were in the legislature, you were a real champion of regulatory reform. This was a passion of yours. Now, Obama has all these executive orders that have, you know, bulked up the bureaucracy and helped bolster the liberal agenda. What do you think the outlook is in terms of rolling back some of the things Obama has done?
Well, it is the story to tell. I mean, that the reality is that if you date back to school when you used to watch, you know, a bill on Capitol Hill and, you know, you'd hear about how a bill becomes a law, there was this deliberative process that involved the House and the Senate with a signature from the executive branch, whether it be the governor in the states or the president and the federal government. But the reality over the last, you know, I think it's about 70 years, but really has ramped up lately, is that most of the damage that is done in the bureaucracies is done through administrative rulemaking and done through the federal level executive orders, which is essentially that the president decrees it, the agencies go out and implement it. There is presumption that what they have the authority to do it. So if you don't like what happens, you know, you have to go out and challenge it in court and determine whether or not the president has that. And then all the agencies, the EPA and all these different groups across the country promulgate rules, which I got news for you. A rule, if you have a business, they can shut your business down if you violate the rule. They can put you in jail if you violate the rule. So when people say rules, it's really just a law. But the collection of bureaucratic proliferation of rules in combination with executive orders creates what, it's not a shadow government, it's the primary government, because in a country where you don't have a annual budget passed by Congress and signed by the president anymore, this is really what you're talking about. So one of the very fascinating elements of Barack Obama's presidency was his willingness, because he, for the last 6 years did not have a sympathetic legislature, really took to the use of the executive order pen. And I would say, most of what you hear is that all, if not all, certainly most, an overwhelming majority of these rules will be, or executive orders will be wiped out in the earliest hours of a Trump presidency. And then the question is going to be whether or not the president-elect and the Congress has the will to cede power. I mean, part of what makes the United States so special is that our executive is restrained and oftentimes has to restrain themselves. And it appears that we have a Republican majority House and a Republican majority Senate. And with Donald Trump as the president, one of the most important things they might do is to put a permanent check on this, to say that this idea that without any sort of passage or deliberation from the legislature, you can create whole new bodies of law. And that's something we really need to look at, because it costs money and it limits freedom and it causes,
all right,
it causes problems. So I think,
all right, thank you, Chris Doerwerth.
Appreciate it.
This is Roger Stone, back at InfoWars, filling in for the great Alex Jones. Privileged to be here. We're talking politics. We're focused on the recount some. But now I'd like to turn to the question of whether Bill and Hillary Clinton and their greedy little daughter, Chelsea, will be prosecuted. You see, at the height of Watergate, we were told that no person is above the law. Now, I appreciate the sentiments of President-elect Trump, who said last week in a New York Times interview that it would not be his inclination to prosecute the Clintons. But I would also argue that we don't even have a full catalog of their crimes, and that the treasure trove of emails that were kept by Huma Abedin and Anthony Weiner contain solid advice of treason, corruption, sexual exploitation, and worse. When FBI Director Comey said on the Monday before the election that the FBI had reviewed those emails, 650,000 of them, and determined that they were insignificant, he was lying. Members of the New York Police Department, who first located and reviewed the emails and forwarded a copy to the FBI, tell me otherwise. And therefore, I think the president-elect's comments may simply be premature. In fact, by early next year, they may be outdated. I am one who believes that in both the email scandal, particularly given the prosecution of General David Petraeus, and in the Clinton Foundation scandals, which, believe me, is a cornucopia of illegal activities to line the pockets of the Clintons and finance their machine, that there are many, many prosecutable crimes. So you can do two things. You can go to stonecoldtruth.com, where there is a petition that you can sign to President-elect Trump and to Attorney General designate Jeff Sessions, insisting on the prosecution of the Clintons. Or you could go to chargehillaryclinton.com and sign a similar petition. In numbers, there is strength. It is vitally important that we demonstrate that we are a nation of laws, not a nation of men. And indeed, no man and no woman is above the law. So please go to those sites today. Sign up for the activism that will be necessary. We may have to remind those in Washington why it's so important that we prosecute. But at the end of the day, I believe the news stories in the beginning of 2017 that detail crimes by the Clintons, crimes we haven't even heard about yet, crimes that the American people are unaware of, I think that that justice can and will be done. Let me borrow a phrase from Al Sharpton. No justice, no peace. So go to chargehillaryclinton.com and sign the petition today. This will be one of the major talking points for the pro-Trump rally and demonstration that we plan for the banks of the Potomac on January 20th. One other piece of advice I'm going to give you very quickly. Go to the InfoWars.com store and grab some of the Brain Force. It's the thing propelling me through the show today. It's a dynamite product that helps your mental clarity, your focus, and your energy. I can't say enough about Brain Force. I popped two of them about an hour and a half ago. And thanks for being here at InfoWars. This is Roger Stone sitting in for Alex Jones here at InfoWars. And continuing today, we're going to focus now on the controversy in Washington regarding the choice of our Secretary of State. Joe Scarborough from Morning Joe claimed that Donald Trump was upset with his political advisor, Kellyanne Conway, a longtime friend of mine, because she correctly said on Twitter that there was much objection among the Trump foot soldiers to the appointment of Romney. Now, Mitt Romney didn't just oppose Donald Trump. He called him a fraud. He called Trump a phony. He called him a con man. That's not reasonable political discourse. Even worse, Mitt Romney's borrowed his political philosophy from the Bushes. He's a neocon, bellicose and warming up for war against Russia, a full-throated supporter of the Iraq War, and the other adventures around the globe that Americans are still paying for. Now, when Maggie Haberman of the New York Times wrote that that Trump was not upset with Kelly, Scarborough attacked Haberman viciously on Morning Joe. Here's the problem. Haberman is right. Scarborough is wrong. Donald Trump is not the source of Scarborough's report that Donald Trump is upset with Kelly for pointing out the opposition to Mitt Romney. I know who the source is. It is not Donald Trump. So in this case, a gold star for Kellyanne Conway. I think that she has wisely pointed out the pitfalls in this comity that is taking place. Now, Reince Priebus, the president's new president-elect's chief of staff designate, specifically denies that he has been pushing Romney. Well, he will fit right into the Washington Beltway crowd because he's not telling the truth. And in fact, there are those around the president-elect who seem to think the nomination of Romney would be a good idea. Now, if not Romney, who? That's an excellent question. Rudy Giuliani, the former New York mayor, has let it be known that this is a job that he would like, but it's not clear that he is the only candidate in the running. We also had David Petraeus, who joined Donald Trump yesterday for a meeting, and perhaps Petraeus is under consideration. Now, some reporters have asked me, how could you appoint Petraeus in view of the fact that he pled to a charge of misusing government documents? Well, Petraeus is a good man who made a bad mistake, but he didn't show classified documents to the Chinese or the Russians or the Saudis or the North Koreans, as Hillary Clinton most probably did by putting classified documents up on an unsecure server. No, David Petraeus made the mistake of showing them to his girlfriend, who was writing a book. So he has paid a price for that mistake. Now it's time for Hillary Clinton to pay the price for her mistake. So I actually think the appointment of Petraeus to, say, the Defense Intelligence Agency, for example, would be able to be used to highlight the disparity between what happened to Petraeus and what happened to Hillary Clinton. I also point out the name of General Mike Kelly, who is a former commandant of the, or commander of the Marine Corps, one of another dark horses in the Secretary of State mix. And then, of course, there's Senator Corker from Tennessee, although I think he's a non-starter. Stay tuned for more about the Secretary of State sweepstakes here on InfoWars. Welcome back to InfoWars. I'm Roger Stone, filling in for Alex Jones. Great bite there of the birds to open the segment. Before we go any further, I want to remind you about the Super Male Vitality Formula available at InfoWars.com. Now, there's a special right now. You can get this for 30% off. It's a terrific product. But more importantly, it helps you support the fight for freedom, support the fight for free expression and the beacon of truth that is InfoWars. The revolution isn't free. It costs money to bring you the vital messages that have helped elect Donald Trump and foment a revolution in this country. So go to the InfoWars store. You can find the Super Male Vitality Formula. This has hundreds of five-star reviews. It's a terrific product. You can see what it's done for other listeners. So if you need a lift, this is the product for you. Go to the store now and grab this at 30% off. Now we are joined by Andy Wallace and Linda Habel from the Vote Protectors Organization. These folks are patriots that I worked with very closely in our Stop the Steal effort. They have been on the cutting edge of the liberty-oriented effort to ensure that we had a free and fair election. So, Andy, Lindsay, thank you for joining us here at InfoWars.
Well, thanks for having us on there, Roger.
You folks did a fantastic job in this most recent election. And therefore, I've got to ask, what got you started? What motivated you to start Vote Protectors?
Well, it's interesting. And let me just take a second to thank you for being the front man for the group, and also to thank everybody who got involved, all of our volunteers, all the boots on the ground. I'll tell you, frankly, I'm a daily listener to InfoWars, and we were talking about, or Alex was talking about, election fraud, and it struck me, this idea about exit polling, and I picked up the phone, and my idea was that every American had the capacity to do an exit poll for themselves after they got done voting themselves. So I called in, gave this idea, came up with the name Vote Protectors while I was on the phone with Alex, and started a Facebook page, and it was off and running just like that. And the response was phenomenal, unbelievable response. And within probably 2 weeks, I connected with Andy Bion, who is a tech guy in Canada, and he put the website together, and we were off to the races.
Well, as you know, we were so successful in our launch that six Democratic state committees went to federal court to try to prevent us from taking a simple exit poll claiming falsely that we plan to intimidate minority voters. In every one of those suits, we prevailed, except for Ohio, where, frankly, they jackpotted us by never serving us, so we didn't know we were being sued. Consequently, a lawyer representing us could not show up in court and present our side. The judge, a Democrat, ruled against us. We appealed to the Sixth Circuit, where he was overturned. And then David Boies, the genius who ran the Al Gore 2000 recount, appealed to the U.S. Supreme Court to hear the case. They declined. Therefore, the score so far is Stone 2, Boies 0. I was gratified by that result, but Andy, they called us thugs. They called us hoodlums.
Roger, let me tell you that this was a real eye-opener for me. First of all, I want to encourage people that, you know, you hear on this show all the time that just a normal person can get involved and make a difference. And I'm a truck driver by trade. I didn't know that I could actually make a difference, and I did. So I want to encourage everybody that they can, too. Now, when this website went up, it was absolutely the most benign idea that there was until the Huffington Post somehow twisted something and made up a story out of complete thin air to make out that we were going to be doing voter intimidation and that we were thugs, which is laughable to me. It was the most ridiculous thing, and it just grew and grew through MSNBC and every day in the newspaper, this thuggery story, which was completely fabricated.
Yeah, no, they came up with this idea that we were somehow going to be issuing badges and therefore trying to pass ourselves off as election board officials, that we would be having armbands. It was only a matter of time before they accused us of carrying weapons. This was an absurdity. First of all, we weren't even addressing voters prior to their vote. This was not a poll-watching operation. This was an effort to make sure that the voters tracked. So this is a good question for Lindsay. What kind of data did we collect on Election Day? And what do you feel the problems were at the polls that day?
Well, I feel that the biggest problems were the election fraud. As far as, let me go back a little bit. Prior to the Election Day, we were receiving all sorts of reports with irregularities. Texas is one of the states where people would vote for the Republican candidate, and when they were ready to submit their vote, they realized that it was switched to the Democrat candidate. And many times it was if they were voting straight Republican or also straight Democrat. It was happening in all of those cases. And then we moved on to Election Day. So Election Day for me started about after midnight. So we started receiving all different kinds of emails. And some of them, when the polls opened on the East Coast, were, again, the switching of the candidate for which the people had voted. The other is that in many states, your ballot, there was a paper ballot given. However, there was no way to track your ballot to your voter registration. So you would fill out the ballot, circle in the candidates for whom you're voting, and you would feed it into a machine, and it was gone. You don't know, you had no, there was no recourse. There was no way to tell what happened to your vote.
No paper trail, as they say.
None whatsoever. It was just all undocumented. We also received reports that the ballots were different from the sample ballots that were mailed over a month prior to the election. And the way the candidates were listed were very different, and they were far more confusing when the voter got to the booth. In New York, we found out, in upstate New York, that Hillary Clinton was listed twice. She was listed as the Democrat candidate, and she was also listed running for a party called the Working Family Party.
Well, of course, in New York State, New York State is one of the few states in the nation that actually permits that. So Donald Trump, for example, was the candidate of the Republican Party. He was also the candidate of the state conservative party. You have a multi-party system in New York where you have the Democrats, the Republicans, the Working Families Party, which is really just a front for the public employee unions. You have the longstanding New York Conservative Party, and in this election, for the first time, you had the Reform Party. Which was constituted by getting 50,000 votes in the last statewide gubernatorial election. So the state does allow you to have the cumulative total of multiple party nominations in terms of the manner in which the election is conducted. Andy, let me ask you, are you watching what's going on in Wisconsin, and do you have some trepidation about that. I don't see any evidence that the Democrats have made any case or provided any evidence of actual fraud. Their complaints seem to be these computerized voting machines are hackable, duh, and, well, the polls were wrong. So if the poll showed Hillary winning and Trump won, the election must be wrong, rather than maybe the poll was wrong.
Well, Roger, first of all, let me say that on Election Day, from the beginning to the end, our exit poll results nationwide, and this was consistent. Nationwide, it was basically an 18-point difference in favor of Trump nationwide in our exit polling. So when we get to the final results nationwide, there's a huge variance from what we have. I am concerned about what's going on with these states. I'm concerned what happened in Michigan, only because the big argument is that it was a paper ballot. However, when they were late in reporting, they reported about a week after everybody else did, and they said one of the reasons why they were late was because there was a quote-unquote glitch in the system. That concerns me. In Wisconsin, I don't think there's anything founded there. But if they did a true investigation of Pennsylvania, I can tell you right now, there is without question voter fraud and election fraud that took place in Pennsylvania, and we have that documented. The problem is how do we go up against it with this attack on the election? I feel like, you know, our team, that the Trump team, that the whole liberty movement is sitting back on its heels and acting like this isn't a big deal. And I feel like it's a pretty big deal.
All right. Thanks, Andy. Great organization, Vote Protectors. And thanks for joining us here with this great report on InfoWars. Welcome back. I'm Roger Stone, filling in for Alex Jones. And joining me today is Kate Comptemko, who is a Trump activist here in Florida. Now, I first saw Kate on Newsmax being interviewed by Steve Malzberg talking about music videos that she produced to help promote the election of Donald Trump. And I was extraordinarily impressed because Kate is 16 years old. She writes, performs, edits, mixes her own music, and then edits her own music videos to go along with the soundtrack. These are really impressive. When we put them up at Stone Cold Truth, they got an enormous audience. I'm convinced that Kate Comptemko is a future revolutionary and that the talent she brings to the fight are really value. So thanks for joining us here at InfoWars. Kate, why did you make the video we're going to show here in a moment?
Well, I go to school and I helped organize some of the Trump rallies, but I really wanted to do something else and show my support in a different way. So I wrote the song.
Pretty amazing. Let us go to the video because folks have got to see this.
Chilling new ISIS propaganda video just surfacing, referencing the Paris attacks.
Tonight, the NYPD released a statement. New York City is a target.
It's awful. Two dead, 20 wounded.
It was a bomb.
Tonight, about the female jihadi.
To a new terror attack.
A seven-hour standoff.
There's terrorists stormed it.
ISIS now.
In each case, ISIS.
Every day, every night, we keep on asking why. Thousand lives sacrificed, but still we return and fight. All we ever hear is the same old talk, empty promises about change, filled with lies and the fraud. Who's gonna tell the real story without obsession with glory? There's not a day to spend. Let's make America great again. It's time to act, back on the track. The stakes are high till they deny terrorist attacks. It never stops, enough with fake perfectness, political correctness. Political correctness. know homeless and poor, and still you talk like it's fine. Corruption's taking over everything soldiers fought for. There's not a moment to spend. Let's make America great again. It's time to act, back on that track. The stakes are high until they deny terrorist attacks. It never stops, enough with fake perfectness. Political correctness. Political correctness. Give us something real. Give us something true. Don't let it reach the end. Let's make America great again. It's time to act, back on that track. The stakes are high until they deny terrorist attacks. It never stops, enough with fake perfectness.
Welcome back. I'm Roger Stone, sitting in for Alex Jones here at InfoWars. And now, one of my favorite people, Sean Stone, actor, screenwriter, cinematographer, the son of legendary film producer and friend Oliver Stone, joins us on InfoWars. Now, Sean and I met some years ago in Hollywood. Our politics are not exactly the same, but I respect him as an articulate advocate for his point of view. And I want to talk about his new book, The New World Order. So thanks for joining us here at InfoWars, Sean Stone.
Roger, thank you. My namesake.
You know, I'm going to say right up front, we're not cousins, but we wish we were anyway.
Exactly.
So tell me about The New World Order. You know, I wrote a book on the Bushes, and unfortunately for me, it was called Jeb and the Bush crime family. And 11 days later, after I think Jeb Bush read this book, he dropped out of the presidential race. And therefore the book never got the kind of focus that I wanted to get. But I was trying in that book to expose the New World Order. And I'm delighted to see that you're doing the same thing.
Absolutely. You know, one of the central figures of the book is a man that you would have some familiarity with. That's Henry Kissinger, right? So essentially, it was Kissinger's mentor at Harvard, William Mandel Elliott. He was professor there for 40 years. Professor Emeritus, very influential person, not only on young Kissinger, but young Brzezinski, Sam Huntington, George Bundy. You know, he taught so many people, obviously, in the politics department. And at the same time, Elliott himself was very much under the tutelage of the roundtable groups that Carol Quigley had exposed with his Tragedy and Hope. So when I was looking at Elliott's sort of pedigree, right, his history in terms of assuming that position of power at Harvard, I recognized, wow, he's really very much a disciple of the roundtable movement and their desire to essentially rebrand the British Empire. First as a British Commonwealth, and then I think, essentially, I would say the New World Order is very much the British Commonwealth plus the United States, operating under as much as possible international agreements, international laws, trying to basically institutionalize the destruction of nation states. And they openly used the term New World Order. So it wasn't like I even had to say this was a conspiracy theory. I just said, look, they're quoting on various documents from the 20s all the way to the 50s, this term New World Order very clearly in all their think tank documents and their books that they're putting together, trying to basically formulate how we're going to control the world in the coming, frankly, entering the 21st century. I think that was the strategy, the goal that they were looking to do. So that was the basis of this book. And in many ways, I think it is, it's a small book. It's not a long, huge book, a tome like Quigley's Tragedy and Hope, but it hopefully can give people a sense of the mentality of imperialism and how it has been rebranded into these more benign, what are considered benign systems of power, whether it's the world, you know, the World Bank and IMF or United Nations or NATO and NAFTA and TPP and all these different organizations, these different forms of organizing globalized controls, right, to strip away national sovereignty.
Yeah, these are the seeds of globalism, although in this case, globalism led by the English-speaking nations, I guess. Mm-hmm. Kissinger has an interesting kind of trajectory because, of course, early in his career, he's considered a hardliner. He is considered the hardest of the hardliners. But when he sees a chance to emblazon his name in history, he really travels. He leaves his old comrades behind, and he very much becomes part of the globalist clique. I mean, frankly, when Donald Trump met with Dr. Kissinger in New York during the campaign, just after he wrapped up the Republican national nomination, it kind of sent a shudder up my back. You know, the hair on the back of my head was standing up. I think Kissinger's, has left his moorings long ago. What are you looking for? Now, you have a movie out, as I recall. Tell me about your other project.
Yeah, sure. So the other project is a documentary that we released on RT. RT.com, it's up there. You can watch the whole thing. It's called A Century of War. And it's relevant to the documentary. It's very much more of a we're looking, obviously, the century of war being from 1917 to the present, the U.S.'s century of war since World War I, and how much we've expanded as this globalized, militarized empire. Really, I would say that the U.S. is not an empire in itself, but there is a financial elite, and again, more of an Anglo-American empire that drives it. We've seen this global domination by the military across the globe, but at the same time, we're seeing deindustrialization at home and a lack of the peace. Basically, we never resorted back to the peacetime industries that you would have seen, for example, all the way from the Civil War up through World War II was this tremendous growth and development. And it carried over into the 50s and 60s and 70s, but then by the mid-70s, when we went off the Bretton Woods system, we basically disconnected from in the manufacturing and having an industrial base at home and tariffs and things like this. We really started shifting after Nixon. I would say it was really the breaking point that they shifted hardcore into this global monetarist empire. And so the documentary looks at the consequence to America, really in the deindustrialized epicenter, the urban center, the former urban centers that are now very much decayed ghettos and whatnot in Baltimore, for example, Detroit, and obviously so many other cities that have been decimated by his policies, but not just for the working class, but even the middle class is beginning to shrink, and really they see the consequence of what happens when you essentially financialize your economy, when you turn it all over to the banks and to debt and replace people's real wages with debt. And that's what the document looks at. We also look at the nature of how we can move forward. Some of the things we really promote are breaking from the petrodollar economy, because ever since 73, 74, we basically replaced the gold standard with the oil standard, right? And that's very much been the only thing that's keeping the dollar, I would say, so strong in the world, despite the fact that our economy is, from a physical economy point of view, I think has been failing. But we have this plethora of dollars because of everyone having to pay for their oil through the dollar, right, all over the world. And that's basically sustained the U.S. currency. So it's sort of fictional wealth that's taken over. And, militarism, banking, real estate, medicine, these are obviously major industries in this country, but I think that most people are not fleeing the prospects for their own future. And so we're trying to say, let's reinvigorate the American dream. How do we reinvigorate America? And I think it has to do with not just government spending, but also, you know, having smart spending in terms of infrastructure, things that, you know, people can obviously build, high-speed rail systems, moving towards nuclear fission and fusion processes. We talk about cold fusion, for example, things that can replace the oil economy. We talk about 3D printing, being able to bring job manufacturing back home, for example, closer to home, the idea of local economics replacing the global economics. So that's what we're trying to talk about in the documentary, is how do we revitalize, hopefully, America, re-inspire America, because I see, from my perspective as a millennial, I don't see the greatness that we saw at the end of, was dying by the end of the 20th century, and I see it's been a decline, I believe, really going back to the 70s and 80s.
Well, of course, I'm one who thinks that Nixon's closing the gold window is perhaps his single greatest mistake of his presidency. But Sean, the way you sound, maybe Donald Trump should put you in the cabinet, because I think he's very deeply committed to rebuilding the infrastructure of America, the roads, the bridges, the tunnels, the harbors, the schools, the hospitals. This is a deep passion of his. I know that he is looking at a number of very innovative ways to finance infrastructure revitalization without having to add to our incredible and daunting national debt. He is, after all, a builder, and I think he has to build. This, I think, really connected with blue-collar Americans in this most recent election. Trump is absolutely right.
Yeah.
Fly into LaGuardia Airport in New York sometime. You really do feel like you're flying into a third world country. It is run down. It is filthy. It is not efficient. And it looks like it was 1950. I mean, it's an abomination. Now, Governor Andrew Cuomo has announced a multi-billion dollar plan to redo the airport. There's only one minor problem. He doesn't have the money. So I think that you're going to see some innovative financial alternatives to rebuild our overall economy. I'm kind of interested in the fact that you're on RT. I've seen your show, Watching the Hawks, which I love. And as one who is accused of being a Russian asset, of being a Russian spy, of filling my pockets with Russian money in the most recent election, I've got to believe working at RT is kind of an experience. I mean, I think the Russians were maligned in this election. We got to a point, it seemed to me, where if you weren't for thermonuclear war with the Russians over Syria, well, then you must be a traitor to the United States. You must be in the employ of Putin. What's your take?
For a lot of us, I think that became the major issue for this election. I think people didn't quite account for that fact in Trump's victory, but a lot of people were very concerned about the foreign policy issue, that we feel there's a buildup to nuclear war, World War III, with Russia currently over Syria, which is the most insane story of all. I mean, it's like watching it's really watching 1984 with the Syria situation, where every month the enemy changes. And even a month ago, I think it was, or 2 months ago, Washington Post says, well, we can't destroy ISIS just yet, because they're actually a stabilizing factor now. I mean, this is how insane our liberal establishment has become, so-called liberal establishment. It's an establishment. I think they play both liberal and conservative. But the point is that the establishment itself is insane about Syria. They're so dead set on getting rid of Assad. They're overtly supporting Al-Qaeda-related networks and ISIS-related networks in Syria towards that end. And so because Russia is very much in favor of Assad, keeping Assad in power as a stabilizing force, that seems to have become a red line. And a lot of people, I think, are very scared of what would have happened if Hillary came into power with her mentality that the Russians are public enemy number one. It harkens back to the Cold War. A lot of people grew up with that mentality, so it's easy to fall back into that trap. But the fact is, we still have sanctions on Russia. The British, I think, are a major factor in that, because when you read my New World Order book, you recall that, you know, Russia was the enemy of the British, not the Americans. Russia is much more akin to America, you see, because it's a massive land-based country, has tremendous natural resources, population that spans all of Eurasia. So it's really, it's everything from Asians to, you know, white blonde people to, you know, to Asians and Muslims. I mean, all incorporated into this massive country, right? So it's actually a multicultural nation like America, and a system of industry and technology. So Russia was like America, but the British hated the Russian Empire, you see, because the British were always maritime traders. So they were the ones that were constantly pitted against the Russians. And the Russians even helped America in the Civil War by sending ships to New York and San Francisco to make sure the British stayed out of the war, because the British were going to intervene on the side of the South, because the British liked the slave trade. You know, it helped for their cotton manufacturing, right? It was cheap cotton from the South. So it's really interesting how Russia historically should have been our ally and has been pitted as the enemy because of, I believe, this Anglo-American alliance.
Well, I think President-elect Trump favors a period of détente. I think he favors hard-headed negotiations with the Russians to see if we might coexist in peace. And for that, he was accused of treason. I'm not sure Americans understand how close the Obama-Clinton policies brought us to war with Russia. Now, we do need to resolve the questions of Ukraine and the Crimea. But at the same time, I don't think nuclear war serves anyone. You know, also, going back to something you said, more and more as I've gotten older, I've come to believe that left and right is kind of a device that is used to divide us and extract us from the fact that there is a power elite running the country, indeed the world. They have no ideology other than the ideology of money, the ideology of power. At the end of the day, 3 out of 10 of the Bernie Sanders voters voted for Donald Trump, I think, on the issues of war and on the issues of trade. And I thought from the beginning, my calculation was that had that been 2 out of 10, Trump would have lost. It was essential to get beyond the ideological labels for people to get to understand that in some races, in some ways, and on a number of key issues, Sanders and Trump had more in common than they had apart, and Trump's opponents for the nomination and Hillary Clinton were in fact neocons, a continuation of the Bush-Clinton line of succession that was all planned out for us. So at the end of the day, there were a number of Union Democrats who probably still consider themselves liberals who ended up voting for Donald Trump, bringing him in Michigan, in Wisconsin, in Pennsylvania, the victory that so completely surprised the mainstream media. So just to review, I'm urging people to go out and get your book, New World Order. I ordered it this morning on Amazon. I'm going to look up A Century of War, your documentary on RT. And lastly, just let me thank you for joining us here on InfoWars, Sean Stone, and I'll look you up next time I'm in Hollywood.
Or New York or D.C. It's always a pleasure to see you.
Any place. Look forward. Thanks to you, Sean.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you very much for Sean Stone. I want to remind you again today that you can go to the InfoWars.com store. There's two products here I really like. One I have to mention. It's called Silver Bullet. And it is a colloidal. About 2 weeks before the election, I was exhausted. I was putting in 18-hour days, and I felt a cold coming on. Now, I had read that colloidals were very useful for boosting the immune system, and I immediately ordered a bottle of Silver Bullet, and I got to tell you, it knocked my cold out. It's 50% off now. This is a terrific product. And it works prophylactically. So the minute you feel a cold coming on, I recommend it because it worked for me. And I was right back to the barricades after a couple of doses. It's a terrific product, folks. Welcome back to InfoWars. I'm Roger Stone. filling in for the great Alex Jones. Big shoes to fill. Today, I have a couple breaking news announcements. First and most important, the Hillary for Prison 2017 T-shirts are now available at Infowars.com. This is a fight that is not yet over. Either we are a land of laws, or we are a nation of men. We've been told repeatedly that no person is above the law. That means no woman is above the law either. So let your neighbors know, let all Americans know that we demand that the justice system run its course, and that the decision about prosecuting Hillary Clinton be made not by the president, but by a grand jury and by a judicial process. So help us demand the prosecution of the Clintons by getting your Hillary for Prison 2017 T-shirt available at the Infowars.com store now. I'm going to be giving these out for Christmas as well. The other the other announcement I want to make is that my new book, The Making of the President 2016, How Donald Trump Orchestrated an American Revolution, is now available for pre-order at Amazon.com or BarnesandNoble.com, and very soon will be available at the Infowars store. Now, this is an insider's view of how Donald Trump got to the White House. And it starts way back in the beginning, 1988, when Donald Trump first made a trip to New Hampshire to speak to the Portsmouth, New Hampshire Chamber of Commerce, and the very first Draft Trump for President Committee was founded. We take you through 2000, when Trump seriously considered running as a candidate for the U.S. Reform Party, the party of Ross Perot and my good friend Jesse Ventura. Then we are going to chart the meteoric rise of Trump to the head of the pack in this year's presidential contest. First, we touch on 2012 and the fact that he briefly led Mitt Romney in the national Republican polls, in the end made the error, I think he would admit that, of endorsing Romney. And then fast forward to 2016, where he zooms to the head of the pack and then enters into a death struggle with Hillary Clinton. This is a fight about globalism. This is both a big picture look at the 2016 election in the style of Theodore H. White's famous Making of the President series, 1960, 1964, 1968, but it's also going to give you behind the scenes vignettes of what was really happening in Trump land. This is a book that I know Donald Trump will like. And we chart the rise of the alternative conservative media and the impact of Infowars in my new book, The Making of the President 2016. I urge you to go to Amazon or Barnes & Noble to grab this now. I believe it will be the first definitive inside look on how Donald Trump pulled the greatest political upset in U.S. history. Thank you for having me here on Infowars. It has been a great experience. Keep an eye on that Wisconsin recount. It's a phony. They have produced no evidence of voter fraud, but we must be vigilant. So keep the faith and victory or death.